So in this session, we are going to learn how to install Grafana on a Linux machine. So in this session, I am taking a reference of my article, which I have written on itpanther.com. And if you want to see all the articles written about Grafana, you can log in to this website, itpanther.com, and then come to Grafana section. And once you do that, you should be able to see all the articles which is written about Grafana. Okay, so here you can go to installing Grafana on Windows or on Linux, and then you can click on read more, and then you will be able to come to the same page which I'm using. Okay, so I'll close one tab and let one tab open. Okay, so what we need to know before installing Grafana on Linux. Okay, so one important thing which we need to know is that Grafana needs one database to keep its application related database. Okay, so by default Grafana uses SQLite. Okay, that is the database which is embedded in this software. So what that means is that when you are downloading Grafana and installing Grafana, you don't need to download and install SQLite separately. It just gets installed when you install Grafana. However, let's say for some reason you don't want to use SQLite, you want to use any additional database which can be MySQL or PostgreSQL. In that case, there are some additional configuration is required. So we will do those things in upcoming sessions. In this session, we are just going to stick to installing Grafana in a default mode, and that's why it is just going to use SQLite. Now, once you install Grafana, you access Grafana using a web interface. So basically, it is you are going to need a browser in order to access Grafana. Okay, so the browser which can be used is Chrome, Firefox, Safari, or Microsoft Edge. So it supports all the modern browsers. Okay, so whenever we are using any web-based application, there are two things comes into picture. One is the URL and the other thing is the port. Okay, so Grafana by default uses 3000 port. Most of the web application when you run it uses port 80 or 8080, something like that. Grafana uses 3000. So there is a good chance that if you install Grafana on the server where other web applications are also installed, it is not going to clash with your other web application because they are running on a different port and this is going to run on a different port. However, it is your job to ensure that you are not using this port already before installing Grafana. If you are doing that, then you need to make sure that you change the port of Grafana before starting Grafana services. Okay, so we will see those things later. Now, depending on the Linux or Unix flavor you are on, you can choose which command you want to use to install. So in this case, since I'm on CentOS, I'm going to use these commands. Okay, so now let's go to the server. I already have a server and I'm logged in as Grafana admin user, and my current working directory is /home/grafana-admin, and hostname of this server is itpanther02. And if I do ls, you can see right now I do not have anything stored here. Okay, so we are into /home/grafana-admin, and this is a blank directory, there is nothing there. Okay, so now let's begin by copy pasting this command. And now what this command basically does is it is going to download this RPM from dl.grafana.com website. Okay, and if you are on Unix or Linux system, you already know that wget is the utility which you use to download anything, okay, on a Linux system. So I will use wget, hit enter, and let's see what happens. Oops, as you can see, for some reason we are getting the error. So basically what has happened here is we do not have wget already installed. Okay, so If you are in the same situation like me, you are also probably going to get the error, some similar error. And now the thing which you need to do is you need to install wget. So for that we are going to do sudo yum-y install wget. Okay, so this is the command to install wget and it is pretty simple. So if you do not have wget, use this command, hit enter, and it is going to install wget. So once that is done, I'm going to clear the screen and then I'm going to run the same command which we were trying previously. Okay, so wget followed with the rpm URL. Hit enter. This time you see downloading has started and we were able to download rpm file with 68.1 MB in size. Okay. So if I do ls-lrt, this time you can see now we have Grafana RPM already on our server. So now I'm going to go back and I'm going to see the second command, which is sudo yum install, and we need to give path of the RPM. So here we need to copy paste the same thing, and just make sure if you have downloaded any other version of Grafana, just make sure when you are installing it, you give the same name. So what you can do is you can just remove whatever is here and you just need to make sure whatever you have downloaded, the same thing is copy pasted here. Now hit enter and it is going to install Grafana. Okay. Now here it is asking for confirmation, so you can press Y to continue installing Grafana. And now you see some success message saying that Grafana is successfully installed and it is completed. Okay, now you see some messages here. Okay, so basically what it is saying is not starting on installation. So what it means is that by default it has installed Grafana but it has not started Grafana services. Okay, so now how do you verify whether Grafana is started or not, or whether it is running or not? Now the way to do that is you can use sudo systemctl and you can use status, and then you need to type this grafana-server.service. Okay, hit enter, and here you can see the status that Grafana is inactive. So when you install Grafana, by default it is in deactive mode. Okay, now what do you do when you need to start Grafana? Okay, so you use the same command. Let me clear the screen first. So I'll press Ctrl C and then next line I will type clear, hit enter, and here we will basically type the same command which we used for status, and then we are going to change status to start. Okay, and then if I hit enter now, I'll be able to, you know, start Grafana. But before we even do that, I'm going to press Ctrl C again to cancel this command. I have not run this command yet. Now the other way basically to check if Grafana is already running or not is using telnet command. So telnet command is going to tell you whether you are able to listen on a particular, you know, port. So if I do, now we know that Grafana runs on port 3000. So if I do telnet localhost 3000, basically it should be able to telnet. So it should be able to connect. Okay, and please note you will only be able to run this command if you have telnet installed. Okay, so if you do not have telnet installed, it is probably going to give you some similar error which you got in case of wget. So let's hit enter. And we see we are getting the similar error which we got in case of wget. So as we know, the next thing which we need to do is we need to install telnet using sudo space yum space hyphen y install telnet. Hit enter, should take a couple of minutes and should install telnet. So now we see telnet is successfully installed. I'm going to clear the screen and let's run telnet localhost 3000 again. Hit enter. We see we are getting error saying connection refused. Okay, so what it means is there is no service which is listening on port 3000. So that's other way of checking whether Grafana is running or not. Okay, so if you are troubleshooting or if you want to make sure that Grafana is running on any server or not, you can use this command. And if your Grafana is running on a remote server, so rather than localhost, here you need to provide the actual IP address of the server. So something like this. Okay, this is how you check whether port 3000 is listening or not. Alright, so let's clear the screen. And this time we are going to start Grafana by using sudo systemctl start command. And make sure you type grafana-server.service, hit enter, and it is going to start Grafana. So you have not got any message in return, you just run this command and it makes your prompt change to the next line. And now if you want to see the status, you need to use status command again. Hit enter, and now you see it is showing it is active. So that is how you know that Grafana is running. Now let's run that telnet command again and let's see what happens this time. So now if I do telnet space localhost space 3000, hit enter, this time you see we are getting the message that connected to localhost, which means there is some service which is listening on this port, and we know that service is Grafana service. Okay, so I'm going to press Ctrl C to escape. And now we can clear the screen. Okay, so now we know Grafana is going to run on the URL which is going to be your server hostname followed by port 3000. Okay, so if you do not have DNS, then probably you need to use IP address. In my case, I need to use IP address. So this is the IP address of this server, and I'm going to open a new tab. I will type the IP address followed with the port, which is 3000, hit enter, and you should be able to see Grafana launching. If you do not see Grafana launching, it means for some reason installation was not successful and you need to further troubleshoot what went wrong with Grafana. Okay, now you see it is prompting us with email and password. Now if you remember, we haven't really set up any email or password when we installed Grafana. Okay, so what we need to do is there is a default username and password which we need to use. So that default username and password is admin admin. Okay, so let's type admin, password also going to be admin, hit enter, and now we see it is saying we are logged in, also giving us prompt to change the password. Okay, so I'm going to change the password. If you want to skip this step, you can use skip, but it is always a good practice after installing Grafana, change the password, because as you know, anyone who is aware about Grafana, they'll be knowing that default username and password is admin admin, and they may try to, you know, use default admin credential and will be able to log into Grafana if you haven't changed the username and password. Okay, so basically the password which you should be changing. And click on save. Now you see you are going to go to the screen of Grafana. Okay, that's how Grafana looks like when you install Grafana and access Grafana for the first time. Now I'm going back to my article. So here I have also written how you can manage the services, which is basically how you start, stop, or check the status of Grafana services. Okay, so let's say if I want to stop Grafana, so what I need to do is, it is going to be the same command which you used for checking status or starting, and the only thing which you can change here is this keyword. So you change it to stop Grafana. Hit enter, and now Grafana is stopped. How do you verify? Now to verify, you can use status. Hit enter, here you should see the status is set to inactive. The other thing is when I go here, if I refresh, I should not be able to see this page. Okay, so I have refreshed. It is trying to connect and it is basically giving us error saying site cannot be reached, because we know we have stopped Grafana services. Okay, I'm going to start it one more time. And let's go back to this website of Grafana. Okay, and hit refresh. Now we see we are able to log into Grafana again. Now let's say for some reason you want to uninstall Grafana. So the step for that is, if you have Grafana already running, first thing probably a good advice is you stop Grafana. So now if I refresh, I'll not be able to access this, you know, Grafana page, and it is going to give us an error. Now if you want to uninstall Grafana, we need to use this command. Okay, so sudo yum remove. So let me clear the screen first. Let me do ls-lrt. So if you remember, this is the RPM which we had downloaded. So we need to use sudo space yum space remove space the RPM which we have downloaded, and here we need to take out .rpm. Okay, so just take out .rpm and leave the remaining part. Hit enter and it is going to uninstall Grafana. Okay, so I'm going to hit enter and it is going to make sure that Grafana is uninstalled. It is asking for confirmation. I'm going to give Y for confirmation. Now you see it has uninstalled Grafana. Now if you run command of checking status, it is basically going to give you error because there is no service named grafana-server.service is running, or your operating system cannot recognize anything like this. Okay, because Grafana is totally uninstalled from this server. So that's it in this session. Just to summarize, in this session we have learned about Grafana prerequisites like database, and we also know what are the supported web browsers. Then we learned that by default it works on port 3000, and also we followed the steps to install on CentOS, and then we went on logged into the Grafana by using admin credential, which is the default one. We also changed the password, and then we learned on how to stop or check the status of Grafana service, and then we also went on to uninstall Grafana. So in your environment, if you don't want to uninstall, just skip this step and follow on the remaining steps. So in this session, we are going to learn about installing Grafana on a Windows machine. So when you are installing Grafana on Windows, there are two approaches which are available. So approach number one is you can download MSI version of the software. So MSI is an installer. So basically you install it using the same approach which you use to install any other application on a Windows machine. So you're going to download this, you double click on this, and then it is going to launch the setup wizard. And the second approach is installing standalone Windows library. Okay, so in this case, you download the zip file and then you extract that zip file, and inside that you are going to have binaries. By binaries I mean is like grafana-server.exe, which you can then double click to launch it. So the first approach you should be following when there is no restrictions on your laptop and you have admin access and all those stuff, then you can just follow the first approach. And in case there is any restrictions on your laptop in terms of, you know, admin access, or there is any organizational level restrictions, then you can follow the second approach. Now by default Grafana is going to run on port 3000, and this is the same case when you install Grafana on any platform. So regardless of which platform you install, it is going to by default run on port 3000. So you need to make sure that no other application is running on this port. Okay, just make sure before installing Grafana that there is no other application which is running on this port 3000, If there is, then you should be changing the port of Grafana, okay, so that it is not going to clash with your existing application. So now let's follow the first approach and let's begin. So I have clicked on this link and it has started downloading the software. As you can see on the left bottom side, that software has already been downloaded. Okay, so if you want to download the software, you can go to itpanther.com then /installing-grafana-on-windows. So it is going to open up my article which tells about how to install Grafana on Windows machine. Otherwise, if you come to itpanther.com, you can go to blogs section. In the blog section, then you can move on to category and then you can move to Grafana, and here you will see all the articles which is written about Grafana. It is about installing Grafana and there is a lot of other stuff. So here you can go to the article which talks about installing Grafana on Windows, and then you are going to come to the same article which I am showing you now. And then if you click here on download Grafana, so basically it is going to download the software. If you see on the top left side, so it is basically pointing to, you know, dl.grafana.com website, and it is going to download the software from there to your system. Now once you double click on this software, after downloading it is going to launch the setup wizard. And as you see here, the MSI version sometimes give, you know, security warning and stuff like that, because your antivirus may be blocking this. But you know, this is a genuine software, so you should click on more info, and then you are going to get option of running the software. Okay, by default, if you see, you only see don't run. Now if you click on this link, you can see at the top, you know, at the left bottom side, that it is a software which is being downloaded from Grafana.com, which is a authentic website for Grafana. Okay, so I'm not going to click on don't run, going to click on more info, and then I'm going to get option of run anyway. And once I click on run anyway, the installation is going to begin. Now installation is very straightforward. So you click on next and you need to accept the terms and license agreement. Click on next. And then here you see the default location which is pointing to C drive. So now if you are in a production system, always make sure you change the location. Since here I'm not going to change the location, I'm just going to show you here you can change the location. But since I'm not running on production, I'm not going to change it. In your situation, always make sure do not install Grafana in C drive, because if operating system crashes, you are going to lose Grafana, and you know, you are basically going to lose all the stuff which is done in Grafana. So I'm going to click on next, click on install, and it's going to take a couple of minutes, again depending on the system resources you have available on your system. So here it has taken around 8 to 10 seconds and installation has been completed. So click on finish, you are pretty much done, software is installed. Now you should be open Grafana using Grafana web URL. So let's close this. And now we should be able to run Grafana. And to do that, the URL which we need to use is http://localhost:3000. So I'm going to copy paste this in the web browser. And now you should be able to see that Grafana is launching. If Grafana is not launching, that means there is something wrong. So you should just see what is the error message you have received during installation, and then you should act based on the error messages which are shown. Now here, if you see, there is no email or password which we have given during installation. So what it means is there is a default username and password which is called admin, which you need to use. So I'm going to write username admin and password also is admin, and then it is going to move us to same screen actually, and with the option of changing the password. Okay, So here, always consider changing the password when you are not using, you know, whenever you are using a production server. If you want to skip it, you can skip it in a non-production server, but always make sure you are changing it in a production system. Because anyone who knows Grafana, they also know that there is a default username and password which is called admin, and they may try to log into Grafana application. Okay, as an administrator, you need to make sure that your application is secure. So I always change the password and then I move on to next step. So once you change the password, you are going to see the prompt saying user password changed. And this one is basically the browser stuff. It is trying to save your password, so you can close that. So this is how your Grafana is going to look once you install and log in to Grafana for the first time. So in this session, we are going to learn about how to change the default port when you install Grafana. Okay, so the step is very easy. First thing is, you're still going to install Grafana the same way which you do if you don't need to change the port. So in this lesson also, I'm going to install Grafana. So I'll just quickly going to install Grafana, okay, because we have already covered installing Grafana in previous lesson. I'll just quickly install it and then I will show you what we need to do to change the port. Okay, so the installation instruction is pretty simple. It is there on the article. Okay, just go to itpanther.com and there you can see the article, and from there follow the instructions, or you see the previous sessions in detail where we have discussed about this. So here you see now it says Grafana setup is completed. Now the way to check whether the Grafana is running or not is you need to use this command. Just make sure you change the start to status, otherwise it is going to start Grafana. We just want to see the status, so I've changed it to status. Here we see it is showing that Grafana is inactive. Okay, so which means Grafana is installed but it is currently in inactive state. Now we don't want to start Grafana because we need to change the port. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to make changes in the grafana.ini file where all the configuration stays. Okay, so you go to /etc/grafana/grafana.ini, edit it and change the port from 3000 to any port of your choice. Just make sure that that port is not already used. So here I'm going to open this in a VI editor. Also, I have put sudo in the front because if you remember, we installed this software using sudo. So by default, all the file permission is set to root. So I need to use sudo if I want to edit this file. So I'm going to edit this file and then I'm going to go to the place where it shows port 3000 and then I'm going to change the port. Okay, just you see it is starting with semicolon. Okay, so make sure you change the semicolon. You need to remove this. If you don't remove this, then your changes are not going to be accepted, because by a semicolon what it means is that it is a comment. And also change the port to some other port. So in this case I'm changing it to 3010 and I'm also going to remove semicolon. Do not forget to remove semicolon. Semicolon means comment in grafana.ini file. So once you've done that, save and exit. Okay, so now we are going to start Grafana. So once you hit this command statement to start Grafana, after that we need to run the status command to see what is the status now. It should be showing as running or active. Okay, now you can see it is showing as active and in brackets it is showing running. So yes, Grafana is installed and we should be able to log into Grafana by specifying the complete URL here along with the port, which is 3010. So my server's IP address is this one, so I'm going to use this, and along with colon you need to provide the port, which is 3010 in this case. Hit enter and you should be able to see Grafana. So in this session, we are going to discuss about changing the default database of Grafana application from SQLite to MySQL. Okay, so as you know, by default, Grafana uses SQLite. And let's say for some reason, we don't want to go ahead with SQLite database. We just want to change it to MySQL database because maybe your organization follows this standard for databases. So in this session, we are going to discuss how to achieve this. As a Grafana administrator or as a Grafana developer, I don't think it is going to be your job to install MySQL. So it is a general assumption that there is going to be a DBA in your organization who is going to give you access of MySQL. And he's also going to install the required database for you. Okay. However, if you still want to see the steps of installing MySQL, then you can follow along. I have put all the steps of installing MySQL here. So I'm just going to install MySQL first, and then we will discuss about making a change in the database of Grafana. Okay, so yeah, let me copy all these lines one by one. So these first three set of lines is basically what it is going to do. It is going to install MySQL server. Okay, so I have the same server which we used previously, so you can check the host name and the directory and the user. Okay, so I'm going to run these commands one by one. So first command is just downloading the RPM. Second command is just setting the package. Now we are going to install this package using yum install. So as you see, basically it is pretty simple. We fired the first three commands, and then we accepted the prompt, and now it is going to go ahead and download the required binaries, and then it is going to install MySQL. And the MySQL version which it is going to download is 5.7 in this case. So depending on the speed of your internet and also the system resources, it can take some time. Okay, if you are not aware, actually MySQL is now MariaDB. So if you see something related to MariaDB and all, so you just ignore it. Basically now MySQL is also called MariaDB. Now we are going to start the services of MySQL server. So before we do that, I'm just going to use status command to see the current status. Okay, so right now you see it is saying it is inactive, so it is not started yet. Now we are going to follow the command to start MySQL. It is going to take some time and then going to start MySQL. Okay, so it has taken me to next prompt, which means services are started. So I'm just going to check the status again by using status command. Okay, so now we see it is saying MySQL service is active and it is running. So that is what we wanted to see. And now there is something called temporary password which MySQL generates as part of SQL, initial setup and installation. So I'm just going to use grep command to check that password. Okay, so this is the default password which it has generated. In your case, this may be a different password. And now I'm going to run these commands and going to create a database, okay, which Grafana is going to use. And also I'm going to create a user which is going to be used by Grafana. Okay, and then we will provide this DB and user related information in Grafana configuration file. So this first step is still part of, you know, MySQL installation and setup. So I'm just going to type this and I'm going to copy this password again, because when we are setting up this MySQL secure installation, it will be prompting us to enter the password. So this is the password which is being generated. I copied it and then paste this sudo space MySQL underscore secure underscore installation and hit enter. So you see now it is asking the password of root. So I'm going to give the password which I copied from here. Now it is asking new password, so enter the new password. Okay, the password which I have given is doesn't comply, so I'm going to choose the new password. So in this case, okay, so new password has been accepted. Now I'm going to change the password for root. So it is asking whether do we want to, you know, use existing password for root or do we want to change the password for root. So I don't want to change the password for root, so let it be no. And so when you install MySQL, there are some anonymous users and also some default, you know, sample databases gets installed. So these prompts are basically asking, do we want to remove those, you know, stuff. So in this case, we want to remove, we don't really need any anonymous user or, you know, any of the existing data. So I'm just going to select yes. And so it is asking, do we want to allow root login from remote servers? Okay, so in this case, I just want to, you know, login with root user only from this server. So I'm just going to select it no. Otherwise, if you keep it yes, then people from other servers will be able to use MySQL server and connect to this server using root username. Okay, so I don't want that to happen, so here I am selecting no. Now here you see there are some test databases which MySQL may have as part of installation, so we want to get rid of that, so I'm just going to select no, hit enter. And in the reload privileges table, you can just select yes. Okay, so it says all done, and now our MySQL is set up. Now the way to log in to MySQL is MySQL space hyphen u. Then I'm going to use root user and then space hyphen p. Okay, so after hitting the password, correct password, I've been able to log into MySQL. So here if I do show databases, now I can see, you know, some system databases which are available there. Other than that, there is no, you know, junk databases or any other stuff available there. So now what we will do is we'll create a database for Grafana. I will name it Grafana DB. Okay, the same information I have updated here. So we are going to create a database which is going to be called Grafana DB. Then I'm going to create a user which is going to be called Grafana. And the password for that user is going to be Grafana. Okay, so that this is a command you use to create a user along with the password. And the next statement is basically granting the access on Grafana DB. Okay, so this is the database which we had created. Now we are assigning the privileges on Grafana DB and we are you know, assigning, this is the user to whom we are assigning the privileges. So the username is Grafana, which we have created, and localhost is just our server in this case. Okay, so let's run these commands one by one. Okay, so it says query okay, it means it has created the database. So if you want to verify that whether database is created or not, you can run show databases again, hit enter. Now you see Grafana DB database has been added. Now I'm going to run this command. So it is going to create user and also going to assign a password. Okay, so yeah, it doesn't match the, you know, security compliance and stuff. So I'm just going to have one uppercase, remaining lowercase, and probably I'll just name it to, you know, 2020. Just make a note of the password which you are setting up so you don't forget it. Okay, then hit enter and you are done. So it has created the user and has set up the password. Now we are going to assign all the privileges on this database to this user. The username is Grafana. Okay, so this also executed successfully. And now flush privileges is just, you have to execute after you assign all the privileges. Okay, so yes, all the commands executed successfully. Now we should be able to connect using this user. Okay, so now I'm going to exit from here and then I will use MySQL hyphen u and we will provide new user, which is Grafana in this case, and also I'm going to provide the password, which is going to be the new password which we have set up. So now you see I'm able to log in, and this time we have logged in with the new user. Okay, this is not the root user which we have used. So this ensures that we are able to connect to newly created database. Now I am typing show tables command, hit enter. Okay, so it says we need to select one database, so I'm going to see list of databases. So the command to do that is show databases, and then I'm going to say use Grafana DB. Now it is going to use Grafana DB. So now if I run show tables again, so it says there is no tables. Okay, so right now we do not see any tables, and basically when we change Grafana INI configuration to use this database, that time you will see Grafana is going to create lot of system related tables or application related tables here. So we will verify this again. Now I'm exiting from here. And now we need to make changes in this file, which is grafana.ini file. So by default, the location is under /etc/grafana if you are installing using package manager. So I'm going to this location, and under this location, I'm going to change the URL, okay, which is going to be MySQL. This is just the syntax which you need to follow. And Grafana is the username here. And then we have the password, which is in this case not going to be Grafana. I need to change this password to the new password. And then it is going to be @ server name and the default port on which it is running, which is 3306. MySQL DB runs on port 3306 by default. So we haven't made any changes, so we are still going to use this. And Grafana DB is the name of the database. So now let's go and edit this file. So you can edit this file in any editor you want. I just use VI editor and search for word MySQL. So once you search for MySQL, you will see there are things like, you know, you have option of specifying type, then host name, then name, and then username. So either you can specify all the database detail here, or otherwise you can use the URL syntax. Okay, the URL syntax, I find it much simpler because everything is in one line. So by default, Okay, so here we need to, if it is, you know, if you see semicolon in the beginning, just make sure you remove that semicolon, and URL, change the URL to MySQL, provide colon, and then double slashes, then it is going to be Grafana, which is the username, and then we need to provide the password, which is going to be Grafana at the rate 2020. Okay, I'm just going to keep it in quotes because I guess it may, you know, because we also have at the rate as part of syntax, so I think it may give some problem. So that's why I'm keeping it in quotes. Now I'm using localhost, which is this server, and 3306 is default port, and then we have Grafana DB, which is the database which we just created. Now I'm going to save and exit. Okay, now we can so here if you type history, you are going to see list of all the commands which you had just typed. So I just wanted to copy paste one of the previous used commands, so I just did history and then copied this command. Now if you see the status, Grafana was already running before we made any changes. Okay, so previously Grafana was using SQLite. Now we have made changes in grafana.ini file, so we must restart it. Okay, so now to restart it, you need to use stop and start command. So first I'm going to stop it, and then I'm going to start this. And before that, if you want to see the status, you can do that. So I see the status now is it's not running. So now I'm going to start it, hit enter. Okay, so seems like it is giving some error. Let's see the error by going into these details. So I need to use sudo to use this command. So now what I suspect is that the issue is with the, you know, username and password. Okay, it says something like start request repeated too quickly. So let's try to start again and see what happens. Okay, so we still see the same error. Okay, so what I suspect is that it is because of the password. Okay, so I'm going to change the password of MySQL. Or the other thing possibly we can try doing is, let me go back to that. grafana.ini file, and here we are going to go to MySQL, and you know, here I'm just going to comment this line, and then I'm going to provide all the information here. Okay, so type, I will change it to MySQL, and hostname is going to remain localhost at the rate 3306. So I'll change it like this, and this is the name of the user, so which in this case is Grafana, so that's fine. Or I believe this is the name of the database. Okay, so and here you need to specify the username, Grafana username. So here what we have done is we have created a new user which is called Grafana, and then the password which we have is called, not, the password is grafana@2020. Okay, so yeah, this looks better because it doesn't conflict with this at the rate here. Let's run it. Okay, so this time it has taken longer, so I believe it would have started the services. Okay, yes, we do see Grafana services starting correctly. So let's now go to MySQL using username, which is Grafana, and password, which is going to be the password which you set up. And now we are going to use Grafana DB, and then if we do show tables, now we can see there are 35 rows inset. So means there are 35 tables which has been created by Grafana. Okay, so this is verifying, or this is confirming that now Grafana is using, you know, MySQL database. Okay, so that's how basically you can make changes in the database. Okay, and yeah, as a side note, I will also check how you can use, you know, URL syntax if your password contains @. Alright, so that's it in this section. So in this session, we are going to talk about making default port changes of Grafana on a Windows machine. If you remember that we have installed Grafana, we just left the default path, which means Grafana is installed in C drive, and inside C drive by default it goes into program files and inside Grafana Labs directory. Okay, so inside Grafana Labs, if you see, we have Grafana folder, and inside that we have conf directory. So this is the directory where we have configuration file. So on a Linux machine, we have something called grafana.ini file. So here we do not have grafana.ini file. What we have is something which is called defaults.ini file, and then we have something which is called sample.ini file. Okay, so you can copy this sample.ini file and paste it again here and rename it to custom. Now whatever changes you want to make, which is non-default changes, you should always be making in custom. Never edit defaults file. So never do that, never touch this file. Just copy the sample file, paste it again, and rename that with custom. And then this is the file where you should be making all the configuration changes. Now either you can make this configuration changes straight away, or you can stop Grafana first. So now the way to stop Grafana on Windows machine is you go to services.msc from the run prompt, and here you need to search for Grafana services. So here if you search with capital G, you are going to get Grafana, and it is in the status of running. So when it is running, if I go to a web browser, and if I type localhost, now you see Grafana is running. Now I'm going to stop this service. So services is stopping. Now services is completely stopped. So I'm going to refresh this, and once we refresh, we see, you know, it is not able to connect to Grafana. The reason being is that we have stopped Grafana services, right? Now I'm going to go to this custom file again. I'm going to open this file, and here we are going to search for 3000, which is the default port. And now I'm going to uncomment this line. If you see in the beginning, we had semicolon. Okay, this is what we had in the beginning. I removed semicolon, and I'm changing default port from 3000 to 3010. Okay, save this. Do not forget to remove the semicolon from the beginning, otherwise it is just going to be a commented line. So whatever you see beginning with hash or semicolon is just comments. So after you done that, save it, then you can close it, and then you can go to, so here you will not see this Grafana in a you know started mode. So here you need to now right click and need to start it. Okay, so now you see it is changed to running mode. If it is not changed to running mode, it means there may be some mistakes which you might have done unknowingly in the custom.ini file, and that is causing Grafana to not start properly. So now I'm going to go back to this URL, and we are going to change this port from 300 to 3010. If you see, if I try on 300, it is still going to continue giving us error by saying it is not able to find anything which is running on this URL. The reason being is because we have changed the port to 3010. So once I change the port, hit enter, now you see Grafana is running. Okay, so that is how you make a change on Windows Server in custom.ini file. Now if you want to make a database related change, so you open custom.ini file again and you search for MySQL, and this is a place where you can change the database. Okay, so the changes for database are going to be the same, you know, it is going to be the same way which we follow in on a Linux machine. So you can watch that, and then you can follow the same, and using that way you'll be able to change the database. Just make sure database is installed and running on this server, or if it is running on a remote server, then you make sure you provide the proper host name and port here. Okay, so that's it. So in this session, we are going to discuss about how we can upgrade Grafana from version 6 to version 7. Okay, so Grafana version 7 has been recently released, and since we already have learned how we can install Grafana 6 and manage the services of Grafana 6, now it is a good time that we learn about how we can upgrade from Grafana 6 to Grafana 7. So just a quick recap, if we go on to installing Grafana on Linux, you would have noticed that we had actually used these commands in order to install Grafana. Okay, now here you see the RPM which we had used was version 6.7. So now next thing which we need to do is we need to use RPM 7 version. Okay, so we are going to download this 7 version of RPM, and then once we go ahead with the installing RPM version 7, it is basically going to take care of the upgrade process as well. Now before we do that, just make sure whatever the important thing you have already backed up. Okay, so when I say important things, first thing is you make sure you have taken a backup of the database. Okay, and then second thing, make sure you have taken backup of the configuration files. Okay, so if you are using SQLite, then the default directory under which database will be /var /lib /grafana, Okay, inside that you can see Grafana.db. So you can take a backup of this and keep it on some backup directory. And if you are using MySQL, then you can use this command in order to take a backup of MySQL. So if you know, in our case, we have already changed our database from SQLite to MySQL. So we are going to take backup of MySQL. So command is very simple. You need to use MySQL dump command and then space hyphen u. After the hyphen u, you need to provide the username. So in our case, username is Grafana. And then space hyphen h. Hyphen h is the host name basically. So here, since I have installed it on the same server, I'm going to use localhost. After that, you need to give space hyphen p, and after hyphen p, you need to provide the password. And please note, there is no space between hyphen p and the actual password. Okay, and after the password, you need to give space and then the name of the database. So in our case, name of the database is Grafana DB. Now this command is actually going to produce some output. That output we are going to redirect to /home/grafana-admin/grafana.sql file. Okay, that's why we are using a redirection symbol here. So let's copy paste entire thing. And then we are going to move to the server. Now here I just want to show you, if we do pwd, right now we are into /home/grafana-admin directory. And if I do ls, you can see here that we previously had downloaded and installed version 6.7.3. okay, so now let me copy paste whatever is the command to take MySQL backup. And then let's hit enter, and the command is very quick because we don't have a lot of data, and that's the reason it is very quick. However, in your case, if you are using Grafana 6 for, let's say, 1 year, you may have a lot of data, application related data available in your database, and it can take some time in order to take the backup. Now here, if I do ls again, you can see now I have a new file which is called grafana.sql. So this is the file which is containing the backup. Okay, so basically when you take MySQL backup, what it does, it copies whatever is there in the database into a kind of flat file. And then when you restore it, you are going to again run all of these commands which are inside this onto your MySQL database. So if I just do head -10 and grafana.sql, you can see this is what we have. Okay, so these are like all the MySQL statements which is stored inside this file, and whenever you want to restore, you are going to execute this SQL and it is going to load everything back to your database. However, hopefully everything goes well and we will not need any scenario to roll back. Okay, but if you are doing it in a real production environment, always make sure you have a workable backup taken. So in this case, now we can go ahead and start our upgrading process. So I'm going to run this wget command. So what it has now done is it has copied Grafana 7 RPM here. So it has, okay, so now you can see we have Grafana 7 RPM. Now I'm going to run the command which is going to be installing or basically upgrading Grafana. Now here, if you had noticed, you can see here that this package has already detected that this Grafana 7 is an update of Grafana 6.7 which you already have in our system. Okay, so that's how you know that this is actually performing an upgrade of the existing version. Now in this case, it is asking for the confirmation. I'm going to hit Y for yes and then going ahead. Okay, so now it says Grafana upgrade basically has completed, and now we can go ahead and see what is the status of the services. So if you remember again from our installation of version 6, we have some commands which we can use to check the status. Okay, so in order to check the status, we need to use sudo systemctl space status space grafana-server.services. So if I run this command here, I'm going to see the status of Grafana. So in this case, you can see Grafana, when it upgraded, it also started Grafana. Okay, and what it means is now I should be able to access Grafana. Okay, so other thing to notice here is if you do cat on grafana.ini file, and if you grep it using port, you are going to get what is the current port. So in this case, you can see we had changed the port from 3000, which is the default one, to 3010. Now I'm going to open a new tab, and then we are going to enter the URL of new Grafana. Okay, so as you remember, we are running this on port 3010. That's why I have given here 3010. Okay, now here please provide the username and the password. So in this case, I need to provide the username and the password, and after that we are able to log in successfully to Grafana version 7. Now here, if you navigate to the bottom left side, you can see in the here if we are, it is showing as Grafana v7. It means we have successfully upgraded from Grafana version 6 to Grafana version 7. User interface of, we're going to discuss about user interface of Grafana. So when you log into Grafana for the first time, you see a very beautiful home page. So that home page is basically built of smaller components which are called panels. So you join lots of panels and you form a dashboard. Okay, so for example, you see here welcome to Grafana, and here you see some text and some links. So this is nothing but a panel. As you can see, once I move my cursor here on the top of this panel, we have something, some arrow, and which is giving us option to view, edit, remove and perform some other actions. Okay, so this is one panel, and then this is different panel. So if I select here, I get the same option again. Okay, so each of the panels can be separately controlled, and you have an option to edit those panels, you have an option to duplicate the panels, and again for each of the panels you can choose different type of visualization. So that's how you are going to create a beautiful looking dashboards. Now here again, if you see, we have list of dashboards shown here. This is again one panel, and then this is on the right side, you see latest from the blog. This is again one of the panels. Okay, so a list of panels is going to be used to create a dashboard. Okay, so we'll discuss about panels when we are going to create our first dashboard. Now coming here on the right side, you see option of dashboard settings. So if you click on these settings, you will be getting some of the options of describing variables or auto refresh and things like that. Again, more on these things we will be discussing later on. So for now, I just want to give you introduction about the user interface. Okay. Now next to dashboard settings, we have something called cycle view mode. Okay, so right now if you see by default, we are on the left side, you see we are getting a panel. Okay, this is the panel which we can use to do lots of configuration and admin related things, and also we can use this option to design our dashboards and panels. But let's say you don't want to show this panel, you want to hide this panel. In that case, you can click here on the cycle view mode, and if I click here one time, you will see that now we do not have this panel on the left side. Okay, now if I click on this cycle view mode again, you can see now on the top we had home. So whatever we had on the top, that has also gone. So now whatever we see on this screen is only the dashboard. Okay, so this is a Grafana dashboard which is built, and that is the only option which we see on the screen. So when you are creating your own dashboard, for example, I already have a custom dashboard created here. So now let's say this is a dashboard which I want to monitor, and I don't really want to see all this stuff on the left side and on the top. So I can click here on the cycle view mode, and then I can click again, and now you see the only thing which I see is the dashboard, and I can focus on monitoring this dashboard. We don't need to worry about any other things moving here or there. Okay, now let's go back to this screen. Now let's say if you want, if if you don't also want to see this address bar and things like that, you just want to see it in a full screen. So since Grafana is running on your browser, and all the browser, if you press F11, then it is going to be, you know, changing to full mode. So in this case, if I press F11 on my screen, now you can see I only see Grafana dashboard. I don't see anything related to browser. Okay, so that's how you can in fact change it to full screen or a complete view of Grafana dashboard. Now to get rid of this or to close this, you can either press escape. That's going to get rid of cycle mode. Okay, and then if you just click on the top, you will get an option to you see this cross option, so you can click here in order to get rid of this full screen mode, or you can press F11 again, and that is going to return to normal view and going to show you the address bar and the title bar of the browser. Okay, so that's how you play around with the screen of the dashboard. Okay, now let's discuss about the options available on the left side. So here on the left side, on the top, first item which we see is Grafana logo. So this is the home screen. Okay, so if you notice, as soon as I move or I hover the cursor on this icon, if you just notice at the bottom on the left side, you see the complete IP address of Grafana user interface along with the port. So basically, if you click here, it is going to take you to the home page. Okay, so if I click here, it is taking me to the home page. So this is the default home page. That's why it is just taking us here on this screen. Now, if you just scroll down a little, you will see an option of search. So if you click here, you can search your dashboard. So right now, I just have a sample dashboard created. But let's say when you have hundreds of dashboards and you just want to search any of the dashboards by the keyword, so you can provide that keyword and then it is going to show you the list of matching keywords. Okay, list of dashboards with the matching keywords. Now if you go back to left side again and click on plus, so this is the place where we create dashboards and we also create folders. So let me just click on this plus and go to dashboards, and then it will be easier for you to understand. Okay, so when you click on dashboard, this is the first thing you see. Okay, now here we have option of adding new panels. So in this one, you don't need to focus how we create panels, but I just want to demonstrate you how you can actually add panels. So from here, you can click on add new panels, and then it is going to move you to this edit panel option. So from here, you can select the visualizations which you want. You can connect to different data sources which are available here. And then you design your panels. Now in this case, I'm just going to go back. And let's say this is one panel and which is titled. We can change the title. Let's call it panel 1. And let's click on apply. And this is our panel 1. Now let's say you want to add more panels. So you can notice on the top you have an option of add panel. Okay, so this is the option using which you can create more panels. So if I click on here, it is going to open one more add new panel box, and here now I can add another panel. So I'm just going to call it panel 2, and let's just click on apply. Okay, so by default you saw panel 1 move down and panel 2 is here. Now let's say if I want to move panel 1 again on the top, so I can, if I move my cursor onto the title of panel, I have an option to drag it and move it either to the right side or move it to the bottom. Now all the panels do not have to be of the same size, so if you want, you can make one panel smaller. So if you click here at the corner of the panel, you will get an option to resize the panel. Okay, so I can have multiple smaller panels and I can have one bigger panel. So if I want, I can make it larger and then we can have multiple smaller panels. Okay, So right now you don't see any data because we are not connecting to any of the data sources. But this is how you organize your all the panels in order to create a dashboard. Okay. Now by default this dashboard doesn't have a name. So you need to click on save dashboard and then it is going to ask you to save this dashboard with a name. Okay, so if you don't give a name, it is just going to be called new dashboard or new dashboard copy. So I'm just going to remove this and going to call it demo dashboard. Now you notice when you are saving dashboard, you have an option of selecting a folder. Okay, so you organize all the dashboards into folders. So by default, you will see only general folder. You will not see infrastructure monitoring folder. This is the one which I have created. So by default, you are only going to see general. And whatever folders you see, you can select that and you can save. Then this dashboard is going to get saved inside that folder. So in this case, I'm going to click on save. And then this demo dashboard is going to be saved inside that folder. Now let's say I don't want to save it inside general folder. I want to save it inside different folder. In that case, you can click on plus again and then you see the option of folder. So if you click on folder, here you have the option of creating folders. Okay, so here I had created infrastructure monitoring. Now you can create any folder and then when you are saving the dashboard, you can save that dashboard and select this folder name. Or let's say if you have your dashboard already created, in that case also you can later on change the folder of that dashboard. Okay, so those are the things which we manage from this plus icon. If you just scroll down again, you get an option of basically home. Okay, if you notice, this symbol and the symbol here looks the same. So this is basically your home page or home dashboard. And here also you have options of managing playlist and snapshot. So we'll discuss about these later on. Okay, and now if you scroll down, you are going to see option of explore. Okay, this is the option where you can connect to different data sources. You can see what is the data available. Okay, and then you can decide on what is the kind of visualization which you want to see and do all those stuff. So basically you can explore your data. Now if you scroll down or if you move to the next option is called alerting. So this is the option where you define all the alert rules. For example, let's say you are monitoring server utilization. Under the server utilization, you are monitoring different components such as CPU utilization or memory utilization or file system utilization. Now let's say once you have any of these utilization reaching to more than 80%, you want some sort of alerts to be sent. So those kind of option you set under these alertings. Okay, and again, whenever you are creating a visualization or whenever you are creating a dashboard, during that time also you have an option of setting alerts. So we are going to learn that. So that's about alerting. Now let's move to next option, which is called configuration. Okay, as you can see, this looks like settings. So most of the settings or configurations which you are going to do, that is going to be done from here. So let's say in your case, you want to connect to different data sources. You want to create Grafana dashboard by connecting to MySQL or by connecting to InfluxDB or Graphite. Okay, or any other data sources. So in that case, you are going to go to configuration and then you are going to configure the different data sources. So just if I click on data sources, it is going to take me on this configuration page. And here if I click on add data source, you will see we have lots of different data sources which we can connect Grafana and create beautiful visualizations. Now if you go back to configuration again, you see we have option of creating users, we have option of creating teams, then we have options of using plugins. Okay, so whatever you see here in the data sources, these are nothing but plugins. So in Grafana you can have your own custom plugin, or there are many plugins which are created by communities you can use those plugins and you can make use of that in order to, you know, have some custom features which are not out of the box feature of Grafana. And other than that, we have preferences. So if you go to configuration, if you go to preferences, here you have an option of, you know, changing the default theme of the Grafana, or you can also change the what is the default home dashboard which you want to see. So let's say if you want to see some other dashboard on the home screen, you can change that. And let's say if the user interface, you don't want this dark theme. By the way, this is the most popular theme of Grafana. In that case, you can change it from dark to light. And once you do that, and once you click on save, this theme is going to be changed from dark mode to light mode. So these are some of the things which you can change from here. Now I'm just going to move back to dark theme. That's what I like. Okay, so that's all about configuration. Now if you just move to the next option, this is the one which is related to admin stuff. Okay, so this is what most of the admins are going to use. They are going to create users. They are going to be creating organizations. But organizations are not more popular, so Grafana is also deciding on to get rid of this organization option. So other than that, we have option of settings. So if we click on settings, we end up moving to a page which is showing us lots of different settings. Okay, so these are the settings which are coming from grafana.ini configuration file. Okay, so if you remember, we had modified grafana.ini file and we had changed the port. So all of the things which are available in grafana.ini, you can see those settings here. So if I search 3010, you can see we have one entry which is called HTTP port 3010. This is the entry which we had changed in grafana.ini. And now from here, as an administrator, I have the ability to be able to see all these settings. Okay, so from an admin point of view, this is a very good option. And again, if you want to make any changes, you can make the changes in grafana.ini and then you have to restart Grafana. Okay, and also if you don't want to make changes in the actual file, which is grafana.ini, in that case you can create custom.ini file and you can make changes in custom.ini file. Okay, we have seen this option when we made changes on a Windows machine. So other than that, we have options related to stats, and then we have some options related to upgrade. So in the stats, we have like what is the volume of users who try to access this, and what are the count of active users or active admins. So these are the things which is going to be useful from an admin point of view. Okay, so that's all about, you know, user interface of Grafana. So if you see, this is very simple interface. There's not too many options. Okay, that's what makes it very simple. However, it doesn't mean that this is not powerful. Okay, we are going to see more of the features or more of the dashboards or panel level properties when we create panels or dashboards. But this has whatever you need in order to create an enterprise level beautiful dashboard. If you just scroll down here, you can see the option related to your user account. So I'm logged in. I'm an admin user. Okay, this is the default user. That's why you see admin here. So whatever user you will be seeing that name here, and then you will be having an option to sign out, you will have an option to change password, and you will have option to select the preference of your own interface. Okay, so whatever preferences you change from here, this is just the preference for your account. So if you change here your UI theme from default to light mode, this is going to be changed only for you. This is not going to be changed globally. Okay, and other than this, we have here little help icon. This is the icon using which we can directly go to communities, or we can go to documentations. Okay, and we can explore more about Grafana. So hope this video gave you good overview of Grafana user interface. And now we are good to start, and we are going to create couple of sample dashboards, and also we'll be learning how we can organize them, how we can save them, how we can make different changes in the dashboards. Creating our first dashboard. In this session we will discuss about creating our first dashboard. So first thing before we start creating our dashboard is that Grafana is only a visualization tool. By default, it doesn't have any mechanism to store the data. Okay, so if you want to create a dashboard, you need to have some kind of data sources. It can be MySQL database, or it can be Influx database, it can be Graphite, or it can be any other supported data sources. Okay, because what Grafana is going to do is it is just going to connect to your data source, and then it is going to create beautiful visualizations. It is going to give you the ability to create beautiful graphs, you know, beautiful visualizations and things. However, Grafana itself doesn't store any of the data which you have. Okay, so if I click here on the plus on the left side, and I can go to dashboard. Now here I have an option to adding new panel, and let's click on add new panel. And then here, if you notice, under the query window we have something called default. Okay, and here we have lots of other data sources available. Okay, so first thing we need to do is we should be creating our data source, so we should be able to see that created data source here, and then we'll be able to select that data source and then create our dashboard on top of that data source. Okay, so right now I'm just going to go back again, and then I'm going to click on configuration, and from the configuration we have option of selecting data source. That's one way of going to data source option. The other way is you can go to home option, and in this case I'm just going to discard it. So you click on home option, and then there you have something called add your first data source. So if you click on here, basically this is just going to take you to the add new data source option. Okay, so that's one way, and the way I prefer is going to configuration and then going to data sources, and after that go and click on add data source. Okay, now in our example we are going to connect to MySQL database. So I need to select MySQL database, but you can connect to lots of other available data sources. Okay, we will see connecting to some of different data sources as well. In this case, we can just go ahead with MySQL. And now select or click on select option here. And then you will be going to the settings option of that data source. In this case, now I have been moved to MySQL connection data source. Now here I need to provide hostname and database, username and the password of the database to which I want to connect to. Now in your case, I believe you should be having a database, and also you should be having the tables to which you want to connect to. In my case, let me show you what I have done. So as you remember, for Grafana we used MySQL database. So in that MySQL database I just created one more table which is called matrix, and in that matrix table I'm just sending some dummy data. That data is basically kind of CPU utilization data, and that data we are going to use for creating the visualization. So let me connect to MySQL and show you how that data looks like. Okay, so now to connect to MySQL, you can use MySQL command and then space hyphen u. You need to provide the username here. In this case, the username which I have is Grafana, and then you need to type hyphen p. And then you can provide the name of the database. So in this case, our database is GrafanaDB. Hit enter, and then it is going to ask for password. So give the password which you have, and then you are going to be connected to MySQL. And by default it is using Grafana database, because that's the database we passed when we connected to this MySQL client. Now here I can do something like select or let's do show star, or actually the syntax is show tables. So we can, once we do show tables, you can see here this is the table which is called matrix. This is the one which I have created. So other than this table, all the other tables are Grafana application related tables. Okay, so I'm not installing MySQL again. I'm just going to use the same MySQL which is used by Grafana application as well, and inside that I have just created one table which is called matrix. And if we want to see the data of this table is, so we can do select star from matrix, and let's say we just want to see 10 records. So I'm going to use limit 10, hit enter, and then you can see that's the data we have. Okay, so we have DT which is date time, we have CPU which is like CPU utilization, then we have IO weight which is IO weight, and then we have idle time of this system. Okay, again this is just the dummy data which I'm inserting to this database every second using one script. Okay, so here you can see on the other side I already have this script running which is actually inserting one record every 1 second along with some random numbers. Okay, so this is something which you don't need to do. If you already have data, you can just connect to that data. In my case I had to create this table and then I'm going to connect to this table. So the things to remember is, now we will be needing a connection information to connect to this database and then connect to this table which is called matrix. Okay, so now let's go back to Grafana again. So here in the settings I need to give the hostname on which MySQL is installed. So in this case we have MySQL installed on the same machine where Grafana is installed. So in that case I can give localhost, and the port on which MySQL running is 3306. Okay, in your case if you have MySQL installed on a remote server, okay, which is different than the server on which Grafana is installed, in that case you need to change here, you need to change localhost and you need to provide the actual host name or the IP address of the server where MySQL is installed. Then here you need to provide the name of the database to which you want to connect to. In this case database is called Grafana DB, so I have given that. And the username is, type the username and password. In this case I have given the username and password, and then that's all you need. Then you can click on save and test, and if it works and if Grafana is able to connect to MySQL, then it is going to show a success message. Otherwise it is just going to show a failure message or the errors which is it is getting. So I'm just going to now click on save and test and let's see what happens. Okay, now here you see data source updated and database connection is okay. So I see all the green signals, which means everything is completely okay and we are able to connect to this data source. Now if you see here on the top, this is the default name of this data source which is called MySQL. Now let's say I want to change it and I want to give some meaningful name. So I can give it name of matrix, or let's call it matrix data source. So for data source I'm going to type DS and matrix in the beginning. So whatever naming convention which your organization follows, you can follow those naming convention, and then you can click on save and test again because we have changed the name, so we must be clicking on save and test. So once you do that, again it is going to say data source updated. Also you are going to see the connection okay message again, and that's the indication that now it is working. Now let's say if you want to make this data source as the default data source whenever you create a panel, in that case you can click this default to, basically you can turn it on, and then matrix DS is going to be the default data source whenever you have any new panel created. So let me turn it off and click on save and test, and then let's see what happens when we go to plus icon on the left side and go to dashboard. So I'm going to press control key while I'm selecting dashboard, so it opens on a new tab. Now it is opening in a new tab. Okay, now here I'm going to select add new panel. Now if you see, when we do add new panel, here we see some other data source. We don't see our data source as the default one. So if I click on this drop down, and then I can see the new data source which we have created, which is called matrix_DS. Now I want to keep matrix_DS as the default data source. So in that case, we should be able to change it to or turn it on, and then click on save and test again, and then you can just close this. I'm just going to close this panel, and this is something custom which I have already made. I'm going to show you exactly how we can make like this. Now let's go to plus and click on dashboard, and now here we should be able to see option to create a new panel. Once we click on add new panel, okay, now here in the default, as of now, I still do not see matrix_DS. Okay, so I have to see what's going on here. So now we can click on plus, and now we can go on to create a new dashboard. So I'm going to click on plus, then I'm going to click on dashboard while I'm holding the control key. So what it will do is, it is going to open this in a new tab, or otherwise you can also right click and then you can click on open link in new tab. So once you do that, now you should be able to see an option to create a new panel. So click on add new panel, and in the add new panel you should have an option of query, and under the query you should be able to see some data sources. And if you click on the drop down, you should be able to see the data source which you have created. In this case, we have created matrix_DS, so I'm going to select this, and then this is the option which I get. Okay, so by default, from the matrix data source, it has selected one table name which is called alert. Okay, so whatever you see after from is your table name. So we don't want alert table. The table which we have is, you already know, that is called matrix. So if you click on alert, okay, just left click on alert, and here you will have an option to type matrix. Okay, once you start typing couple of the letters of your table, then the table is going to be shown here, and you can select the table. So in this case, I'm going to select matrix. That's the table which we have. And the second thing which we need to do is, we need to select a column which is having a date time. Okay, so one thing which you need to remember about Grafana is, Grafana basically deals with a time series kind of data sources, okay, which is also called telemetry data sources. So basically all your data source must have a column which is having a date and time. Okay, so in my case, I already have a table which is having a column which is having date time basically. Okay, so that column name is called DT. So in that case, if I click here, by default it is showing a column name which is called CPU. Okay, so here you can see we also have a column named CPU, but this is not the one which is having date time. Date time is in the DT column. So in that case, I need to click on this column. Okay, as you see, once I move my mouse cursor there on the CPU, it changes to a hand symbol. Okay, so once you click here, you'll be getting an option to select other columns. Okay, so these are the other columns of my matrix table. So in this case, I'm going to select DT. DT is the column which is having date time. Okay, So until now, if you see, we do not have any option, or we don't really see anything here, but we will figure that out soon. Okay, so now we have selected a table name in the from clause, and also in the time column we have selected a column which is basically having a date time. And then this is the statement, select statement, where you select all the columns or all the visualization which you want to see. Okay, in this case I want to see maximum CPU utilization, so we have selected, or rather this was the default option which was coming. But if you want to change this column to any other column, you can click on here on the CPU, and then you are going to see all the other available columns. Okay, so you know our data source has other columns like IO weight and idle other than CPU. So we see all these columns here once we click on the default column option. So here I'm going to keep selecting CPU, and then here on the, if you click here on the plus, you will have options of using aggregate functions. You will have an option of using alias, and you will have an option of selecting more columns. So in this case, first I will click on aggregate functions because I want maximum CPU utilization. Okay, so in that case, I'm going to select aggregate function, and then I'm going to select maximum. And once you click on aggregate maximum, you are going to get an alias as well. So this alias by default is the same column name. I'm going to click on this and then going to change it to max underscore CPU. Okay, hit enter, and that's all you need to do here. Now let's say if you want to add one more column, okay, in that case you can click again on this plus symbol, and then you can click on column, and then it is going to create a new row under this select section. And here you see we have the column name CPU shown by default. Let's say we want to change it to idle, so we can change it to idle. And let's say we want to see the minimum of idle time, so we can change the aggregate function to minimum. And in the alias name, we can change it to min underscore idle. Hit enter, and now you have two columns, okay, and on which you have performing some aggregations. By the way, right now we are working on query editing mode. This is very useful, which I really like to work with this mode. However, if you already have your custom query made, you can use that custom query directly. So we'll learn about that as well. Now the reason as of now you have not seen the data is that is because of this where filter. Okay, so I'm just going to click here on the macro. And once you click on the macro, you should be able to see an option of remove. So I'm just going to click on remove. And then once we do that, once we no longer have any filter, we can see our data. Okay. So by default, you see in the group by we have interval, which is actually anything which is starting with a dollar symbol, that is a variable. Okay, so here dollar interval means is whatever interval you are going to select from here. Okay, here you see you have refresh dashboard, and then you have these are the default intervals. So whatever interval you select here, that's the interval which is going to be reflected there. Okay, again, if you want to remove this, you can remove this. Otherwise, you can just leave it as it is. Or let's say you want to change this interval to different intervals, you have an option to do that as well. So in my case, I'm just going to leave it as it is because this is just a sample dashboard which we are creating. Okay, now this dashboard as of now does not have a name. It has a default name which is called panel title. Okay, so you can click here on the panel title, and then you have some other options. But by the way, if you just click here on, if you just see on the right side, you have something called panel properties. Okay, so in case you don't see this panel properties, that is might be because you have already clicked on this close options pane. So if you have clicked on close options pane, in that case you are just going to see something like this, and then you can click on show options, and it is going to show you the panel properties. Now here on the panel properties, under the settings, we can change the panel title. So I'm going to change it and going to call it CPU utilization panel with matrix DS. Okay, that's the data source which we are using. And if you want, you can provide some description. This is completely optional. I'm just going to copy and paste the same thing here. So if you notice, as soon as you provide some description, you are also going to see one I symbol here on the panel on the top left side. So once I hover over to that section, it is going to show me the description, whatever description is written here. Okay, so it is a good way when you have like 4 or 5 different panels on your dashboard. It is a good approach that you define a description name for each of the panels, so your user can understand what is the purpose of each of the panels. Okay, in this case, let me make it CPU utilization using custom script. Okay, so that's all. Once I hover over here, let me just save it. Okay, so basically take some time to refresh, and once you click on here, you are going to see the new message has starting to appear. Okay, that's one thing about giving panel title and description. The other things which you can do is you can change the visualization. So by default, the default one is graph, but let's say if you want some other type of visualizations, you can do that as well. Again, remember the query which you are using here is going to be different based on the visualizations which you are choosing. For example, if you see here on the stat, it is going to show you only one option. So the query which you need to create for stat is going to be different than the one which we have created here for graph dashboard or graph visualization. Okay, so we'll see about other things later on. Now if you just scroll down, you have something called display. So you can play with displays, different options, and based on whatever changes you make here, the graph is going to get changed. So if I enable bars, or if I, let's say, disable lines, you can see the lines option has gone. You can enable it again. You can change the line width. Let's make it 7. And you can see now I have very thick line. Okay, then again in the area field, you can select different options, and you can see the fill has changed. And in the fill gradient, again you can select something different, and you will see the gradient has changed. So you have an option to make changes on how you want this panel to look like. Okay, those are all available under the visualization display properties. So if I enable these points, and let's say we change the radius of these points, in this case we don't see any difference, but again depending on the visualizations which we have selected, you are going to see different visualizations when you make changes here. Okay, now we will discuss some different options in our upcoming sessions. For now, you have understood some of the basic things about creating a panel. Okay, so when you create a panel, you need a data source to connect to. So first thing, you should always create a data source. Then you can go ahead creating a dashboard, and inside the dashboard, you need to create a panel. Okay, and when you create the panel, you can define the queries here, and you can save the panel with the panel title and the panel description. And then you can hit on save. So once you click on save, it is going to ask for a dashboard name. So I'm going to call it example 01 CPU. Let's call it CPU utilization dashboard. And we can save it under general. Okay, and click on save. And now we have our beautiful dashboard ready. That's only having one panel. Okay, now let's say if I want to have a different panel which is almost similar, and we just want to change that from max CPU to min CPU, minimum CPU. So in that case, you can come here onto the title and you can click here on the drop down option, and you have an option of duplicate under the more options. So you can click on duplicate and everything is going to get duplicated. Then you can come here and go to edit, and this way I can just quickly go to the query and I can change this aggregate from max to min. And let's say I don't want this column, then you can click here on the column. Once you do that, it is going to give you an option of remove. So I just got rid of idle, so the only column which I have now is CPU column, and we are now seeing the minimum CPU utilization. And also I'm going to change alias name to min underscore CPU. Hit enter, you can save it, and you need to provide some description about what is the kind of change which you are making. So I'm going to call it adding minimum CPU utilization panel and click on save. That's all, it's been saved. Now you can click here on the go back arrow or you can press escape. So I'm just going to click here on the go back, and now we have two panels ready. Again, if you want to resize or if you want to rearrange, you can do that. Okay, so if you want to, let's say you want to make it a bit longer, you can do that. If you want to show it just parallel to each other, you can do it. Or if you want to show it under each other, you can do that as well. So that's about creating a dashboard and also being able to visualize that. Now by default, this is going to be refreshed whenever you hit refresh dashboard option from here. And let's say you want this dashboard to be auto refreshing every 30 seconds. In that case, you can click here on the drop down which is next to refresh, and you can select the interval. In this case, let's say we want this dashboard to be changing or refreshing automatically every 30 seconds. So we can select 30 seconds, okay? So now every 30 seconds, this data will keep on changing and you will always see the latest visualization. So now let's talk about how we can use a custom query in order to create a visualization. So I'll go back to again the data source which I have. Okay, so this is the table name which we have, which is called matrix. So let's say we have a query which is called select DT, and then we want max of CPU utilization, and the table name is matrix, and this is going to be a group by on DT. Okay, so that's a typical SQL query which we have. And if I hit enter, or let me also put limit 10, and let's hit enter, and this is the kind of result which we get. Okay, so now let's say I want to use the similar query for Grafana, so I can do that. Let me copy these statements. So I will only copy until DT, I will not use limit 10, because in Grafana we don't want to limit our results to only 10 records. Okay, only for the seeing on the console or on the command prompt I have put limit 10. Okay, so let's go to Grafana, and here again I'm just going to use a short method. So either we can just click on the title of one of the panel and go to more and then select duplicate, and it is going to duplicate the panel, and then we can click on edit on that new panel. And now here in the query, if you see, this is a query A. Okay, this is a query which we created using the query builder. Now let's say I want to get rid of this, I can click on remove query option. So once you click on that, so the query is gone and you do not have any data in the your visualization or the dashboard or the panel which you have. So now I'm going to click on query, and then if you see here, we have a toggle option. Okay, so this is a toggle text edit mode. So if you click on this pencil icon, it is going to take you to a window where you have an option to type the query. Okay, so by default, whatever it has available, I'm just going to remove that and going to paste the query which we have just copied. Okay. Now one thing here is, if right now if I hit enter, or basically I try to save it, it's going to give us error. Okay, the error here is, as you can see here, the error here saying is that there is no column found which is called time or time underscore sec. So whenever you are working with Grafana, you need to have a one column which is having date time, and that column should be called time, okay, or time sec. So now we do have a column which is called, which is having date time, and that column is called DT. Now I'm going to create an alias for this column name, and I'm going to call it time. Okay, so once we do that, this error should be gone. Okay, so again, it takes some time for this to refresh, or otherwise you can click on save, added a panel with custom queries. So that's what I have given an annotation, and this is just some description. So when admin is seeing, he'll be able to see what is that annotation you have given. So more about this later on. So for now, just give some comment and save it. And now here, if you see, we already have the results based on our custom query. Now let's say other than max CPU, you also wanted minimum CPU. Okay, so we can do that by adding one new column which is called min CPU. Okay, again, it's going to take some time before you see it, or you can hit on refresh. You can see on background it is already trying to refresh, and you can see one refresh icon here. Okay, so now this is the data we have. We have the data for minimum and max CPU utilization. Again, notice the data which we have is not really very changing in dynamic. That's why you see the lines almost like kind of straight line, because our min and max CPU utilization is almost similar. Now here, if you come down on the panel, you see legends. So here you see max CPU and min CPU. These are the default name which has been given to these columns. You can change it by using alias again. So I'm going to call it max underscore CPU, and the next one I'm going to call it min CPU. Okay, so once you do that, you'll notice a change here in the legends. You can now see that these values has been changed. Okay, max CPU is already changed, min CPU is going to get changed, or you can click on refresh so it can refresh and take these changes. Okay, so now you can see it has been changed. So that's how you use a custom query in order to create a visualization. Since we already have InfluxDB and Telegraph set up, now we can go ahead and create a new data source. So for that, I'm going to go to configure and then going to select data sources. And under this, we need to select add new data source. And here we need to select InfluxDB. So once we do that, first thing, I'm going to change the name. I'm going to change it to InfluxDB underscore demo. And then in the URL, we need to provide the IP address on which InfluxDB is installed. And the default port on which you can access InfluxDB is 8086. So I'm going to type HTTP and 10.128.0.4. This is the IP address on which we have InfluxDB installed. And the port on which it is running is 8086. And now in the database, so whenever Telegraph sends data to InfluxDB, it also creates a default database which is called Telegraph. So here you need to type Telegraph. And in our case, we do not have any username and password set up, so we can just leave it blank. Now we can click on save and test. And if everything is okay, it should be able to connect successfully. So as you can see, in our case, it is able to successfully connect. However, in case you have Grafana and InfluxDB installed on a separate machine, in that case you need to make sure from Grafana to InfluxDB port 8086 is open. If there is no port connectivity between Grafana and InfluxDB, in that case it is not going to work for you and you may get some error. Okay, so once this is done, now we can go on to click on create dashboard, and then we can add a new panel. And here in the query, by default, you see some default data source. So I'm going to change it to InfluxDB demo. This is the one which we have created. And now here, whatever you see, this is going to be slightly different than MySQL data source. Okay, so in the from, you see default. So default is, this is nothing but just a schema name. So I'm going to change it to AutoGen, because whenever Telegraph sends the data, it sends to AutoGen, a schema name. And then in the measurement, we are going to select CPU. So you see all the CPU, disk IO, kernel, MEM. So there are so many metrics which has been by default collected by Telegraph, and it is sending all this data to InfluxDB. So I'm selecting CPU, and then in the where clause, if you have any condition, you can give that in. I'm not going to give any condition in the where clause. And now let's move on to select clause. So this is the clause where you need to provide the column names. So here I'm going to click on a field. And here I'm going to provide, let's give usage user. So this is the CPU usage by users. And then here we can just keep on selecting mean. Now you saw, as soon as we selected usage user, we could already see there is some data which has started to show up. Now this is one field. If you want to add more fields, you can add, you can click on this plus symbol, and then you can scroll down to fields, and then on the right side you can select field. Then it is going to create one new row. And here you can select new column name. So rather than usage user, here you can, let's say you can select usage IO weight. Now you will see there are two items available here. Now by default, you see there is no segregation of three servers. If you remember, we have installed it on three servers. Okay, so let's say if you want to see all these details for each server one by one, in that case, you can do a group by. So in the group by, you need to select on plus, and then here you need to select on tag host. Tag host is basically the host names, different host names. So now you can see we have three host names. We have a host name which is called ITPanther03. Then we have another host name which is called ITPanther03. Then we have another host name which is called ITPanther04. So these are the three servers on which we had Telegraph installed. And now you can see we already started getting the data from all the three servers. Okay, now in this case, I don't want to make this graph more complicated. So I'm just going to remove this usage IO weight. So for that, you can click on field, and then you will get an option of remove. So you can select remove. It is going to remove that extra column. Okay, so now we see we only have mean CPU usage. Okay, so mean is basically average. Okay, so this is the average CPU utilization from all the three servers. Now, one thing if you say here is duration is pretty large. So we have data from 14, 30 to 20. So that's almost 6 hours. Now I'm going to change that from here in the time filter. And let's say we want data only from last 15 minutes. So we can select last 15 minutes. And then you can see now our data has been changed. Okay, now one thing is here you see all the dotted lines. Okay, you don't see a smooth connectivity. That's because for some time there might not be data available. Okay, so in that case, if you right click here on the panel side and scroll down, you will see something called null values. So if you select null values to be connected, in that case you are going to see a smooth line connecting to each other. Okay, so that's what we want. So that's why I have changed null values to connected. And now one more thing if you notice which is weird is here you see you have CPU mean, which is the name of the function, also being shown here. Now let's say you don't want to see here, you just want to see the host name here. You don't want to see cpu.mean and things like that. So in that case, in the alias by, you can type dollar, and then you need to type tag underscore host. And once you do that, you will notice here it has been changed only to the host names. Okay, again, whatever options which you had available for any other data source, the same options are available for InfluxDB data sources as well. So let's say if you want to increase the thickness of the line, you can still do that. And let's say we want to also enable the points. Okay, so now you can see as soon as I enable the point, you can see some pointers here. And again, if you want to enable gradient, you can do that. So again, whatever the visualization which fits best for you, you can do all of those after connecting to Influx data store as well. And after that, once you have done or once you have made the settings which you want, you can click on save, and then I'm going to call it demo influx db. Let's call it CPU utilization dashboard. Okay, now you can click on save, and then this is going to be saved. So you can see very quickly we have installed InfluxDB, Telegraph, and also we have started getting all the utilization related data, and we have set up our first dashboard on using InfluxDB. So in this session we will see how we can add threshold to any panel. So now here you see this is a graph which we had created, which is telling us CPU utilization from three different servers. So I'm just going to duplicate this panel. So for that you click on the title, and then you are going to get option of more. From there you select on duplicate. Now it has duplicated the same graph. Now on this duplicated graph I will click again on the title drop down, and then I will select edit. So once you go to edit, you will see on the right side we have panel properties. So here you can scroll down and reach to threshold. Okay, so this threshold we need to select add threshold. So as soon as you do that, you will see a symbol with a broken heart. Okay, so this is basically Grafana's way of telling that we are going to cross threshold. Okay, so here you can define threshold of, let's say in this case I'm going to change it to 80%. So this line is indicating threshold. So anything which is crossing that is basically going to be resulted in something not being okay. And that's why you see a broken hearted symbol here. Okay, so yeah, once you do it on 80, and again on this is a critical color symbol which is already been set. So if you want to, let's say, disable the fill, you can disable that. In that case, you are not going to see the above area being filled with red color. However, if you just enable it, in that case you can see the above area which is more than 80% is filled with red color. So from visualization perspective, this is very good. You will be quickly able to identify that the value which is going beyond a threshold. Now you can click on apply and save it. So now you can see the difference between a panel which is not having a threshold, and this is a panel which is having threshold. So let me rename it to CPU utilization graph with threshold. Okay, and now we are going to create a couple of more indicator which can give us single value output. Okay, so in that case let's again duplicate this CPU utilization graph. And then I'm going to move it here on the first quadrant, and here we are now going to edit it, and now I will be changing the visualization from graph to, either you can change it to gauge or you can change it to stat. So let's see how it looks like. So if I click on stat, this is the kind of output which I'm going to get. Okay, and if you click on gauge, you have kind of gauge meter, and you can decide what is going to be good value, what is going to be amber value, and what is going to be red value in your case. Okay, so let's select gauge, and then we can go on to field, and in the field here you can define the threshold. Okay, so let's say I say from base until, let's make it 50. So from base until 50 is, let's make it yellow. And then we are going to add one more threshold, which is, let's call it above 80%. So anything which is going to cross 80%, we are going to mark it as red. Okay, so that's how this is going to look like. Now again, we can change the size of this. And also in this case, let's say we want to get rid of this title. We don't want to have this title name, so I'm just going to remove this because visually it's going to look better. Okay, so now you can see we have something like a single indicator which is giving us an indication about what is the health or CPU utilization health of each of these servers. And here also you can see the trend line. Now let's duplicate this and we can then select stats and let's see how that looks like. Okay, so I'm going to select stat and that's how it is going to look like. In the field also the threshold, whatever we had duplicated is available here. So if you want to play around and if you want to change the values, you can do that. In this case, this seems to be okay and we can just click on apply. And this is another type of panel which we have created. Okay, again, it depends what kind of visualization you want to achieve and based on that you can select the required graph. In this session, we will learn how we can set up alerts in Grafana. So alerts are very useful way of notifying users if there is something goes wrong. So you can actually trigger emails if, let's say, CPU utilization is going very high, or let's say free RAM utilization is decreasing continuously. It means that your system is being occupied and there is very less memory is available in order to process anything else. So these are some of the scenarios on which you may want alerts to be sent. Now, as you can see here, I have a dashboard which is talking about RAM utilization, and then I have a dashboard which is talking about CPU utilization. Okay. And now here, if you notice, we have a yellow line and then we have a red line. Okay. So how this is happening is this is the point at which it started noticing that yes, the RAM utilization is now has reached to the critical threshold. And now from here on, it is going to be continuously checking RAM utilization up to the specified time which we have defined while configuring alerts. And once it reaches that threshold, it is going to create an alert. So at this point of time, it is going to send an email or any other alerting mechanism which you have configured. And then here on the right side, we have critical alerts. So this is basically alerts dashboard. This is Grafana alerts visualization. This one is going to give you all the alerts consolidated at one place. So let's say you have alerts coming from two or three or multiple different panels. For example, this is one panel which is sending alerts related to RAM utilization. And then this is another panel which is sending alerts related to CPU utilization. And then this is one dashboard, okay, which is called Demo InfluxDB CPU Utilization Dashboard. Similarly, you can have hundreds of different dashboards which is sending alerts. And if you want to see all of those alerts at a single place, in that case, you need something called alerts dashboard, and this is a dashboard which is basically going to show you all the critical alerts in a single window. Okay, so enough of theory, let's now start seeing how we can implement this. Now, in order to implement this, first thing which we should be doing is we should be going to alerts and checking about notification channels. Okay, so let me save this dashboard which I have already created, and then I will show you how we can create all of these dashboards again. Now I'm going to alert and then I'm going to notification channels. And in the notification channels, if you see, I have created a notification channel which is, I have given a name of ops team, which is operations team, and the type of alerts is email. Okay, now let's see what are the other types of alerts available here. So I'm going to click on new channel, and once you click on new channel, you are going to be presented with a screen where you need to configure the new channel. Now here you can give a logical name to your channel. For example, let's say this is a list of all the admins, then in that case you can give admin at whatever your email ID is basically, or whatever the group distribution list is. So in this case, let's say I'm going to call it admin at itpanther.com. Okay, and then here in the type, you see we have so many different types of alerts which can be configured. Okay, we can configure email. If you want, you can send alerts on Telegram, which is very good messaging app. You can configure alerts to be sent online, and there are so many other options available. Okay, however, in this session, let's just talk about emails. Now you see the second option or the third option available here is, which is saying default, send on all alerts. So do we want this alert to be sent, or this emails to be sent on all the alerts? So in that case, yes, we want email to be sent on all alerts. So we can enable this. And now you can move down, and here in the email settings, you can put all the addresses. Okay, so in this case, let's call it, or let's say I have a distribution list which is called linux admin at itpanther.com. That's one of the distribution list which is going to send an email alert to all the members which are part of this distribution list. Okay, again, these emails, I assume in your organization you'll already be having all the distribution list. And if you want to send email alerts to multiple distribution list, in that case you can put one email distribution list followed by semicolon and then another distribution list. So let's call it Windows admin at, okay. And then you can also put individually or individual email IDs. So let's say I want to put my email ID, I can do that as well. Okay. And guys, notice one thing. Right now, we do not have SMTP configuration set up with Grafana. That's the reason, okay, whatever we are configuring here is not actually going to send an email, because we have not configured Grafana with SMTP. We will see how we can do that. But in order to learn that, we also need some kind of SMTP details. So we will see in our upcoming session, we will probably going to get one of the free SMTP details, and then we are going to configure that using Grafana. However, in this case, from the alerting perspective, when you have Grafana set up with SMTP, that's all you need here, and then you can just save it. And now you can see you have a logical name which is called admin at itpanther.com. If you want to modify it, you can click on this name again, and then you'll have an option of editing this. So in this case, let's say I'm just going to remove additional domain name from here. The logical name, I'm just going to keep it admin, and then let's save it. Okay, so now we have alert notification channels configured. Now we can go ahead and start creating the dashboard. Okay, so let's go to create and click on dashboard. And here we are going to create or click on add new panel. And the first thing which I'm going to create is related to CPU utilization. Okay, so again in the data source, we need to change it to InfluxDB demo. This is the one which we have configured. And in the from, I'm going to change it to AutoGen. And in the measurement, we are going to take CPU. Okay, now here in the where clause, I want to filter only on one host. So in the where clause, I'm going to click on host. And then in the tag value, we are going to select only one server. Okay, I don't want all the servers. If you want only one server, you can use where clause. Okay, so in this case, let's keep itpanther 02 server. This is the server for which we will be checking CPU utilization. And once CPU utilization reaches beyond a threshold, and
that case we want an alert to be sent. Okay, in the select field we want, let's say we want usage system. Okay, so once CPU usage system is high, we want an alert to be sent. And in the aggregate function, we don't want average, we want max. So I'm going to remove this and going to click on plus symbol again, and then going to click on selectors, and then going to click on max. Okay, so this is going to give us max of CPU utilization at every specified interval. So interval here is, let's change it to every 1 minute. Okay, so this is, hopefully this is clear until now, and let's change the panel title to call it CPU utilization panel. Okay, now if you remember, whatever we configured here, this query has a name, a logical name. This is called query A. So if you click here on this this little arrow, it is going to expand or collapse this. Okay, so this query is basically have a logical name of A. The reason why I'm telling you this, that when now we are going to configure alerts, and in the alerts we are going to refer this query with its name, which is called A. Okay, so now in order to set up alerts, you need to actually do that from the same place where you configure dashboards. Okay, so this is the place where we are actually configuring our panels and dashboard and visualization and things like that. Now here, if you see, other than query, we have a third tab which is called alert. So I'm going to click on alert, and then here you see we have an option of creating alert. So let's click on create alert. Okay, and now it has picked up a name of whatever the panel name was, which is CPU utilization panel, and it has given, or it has postfixed alert in the end. But if you don't like this name or you want to change this name, you can do that as well. So now in the ruling engine, what it is saying is that this alert is going to be evaluated every 1 minute, and it is going to be evaluated for 5 minutes. Okay, and what it is going to do is, this is a condition which is specifying what is the threshold condition. So let's say in the threshold condition, I'm saying whenever max of CPU utilization. Okay, so here you see in the query we have A. This A is the one which we configured here. So in the A we are specifying the maximum CPU utilization. So what this means is, in the current scenario, what it means is when average of CPU utilization for last 5 minutes going above certain threshold, then we want an alert to be sent. However, in this case we will make some changes. So in the, rather than average, I'm going to change it to max, and here I'm not going to make any changes, I'm just going to leave it as it is. Okay, or we can probably change it to, let's change it 2 minutes. Okay, so in the threshold, I'm going to change it to, let's say, 40. Okay, so whenever CPU utilization is going to reach more than 40%, and it is going to reach or stay continuously more than 40%, in that case, we are going to get alert. And that continuation has to be for 5 minutes. Okay, so whenever it reaches more than 40%, for the first time, in that case, it is going to create an alert with a status of pending. Okay, so here you can read that when you click here on this information symbol, you can see here. So whenever this alert is going to reach a certain threshold for the first time, then that time Grafana is going to create an alert and going to keep that in pending status. And once that threshold is going to stay in that situation for a certain amount of time, which is configured here. So in this case, it is 5 minutes. So when we have a threshold reaching around or going above the threshold for 5 minutes, in that case, that pending status is going to be changed into alerting status. And that's the time when Grafana is going to trigger all the emails. Okay, or if you have any other channels configured, like sending notification to Telegrams or Line, so all those action is going to be triggered then. Now in this case, I will also reduce this to 2 minutes because we don't want to wait longer. Okay, and now if you scroll down, we have notification. So these are the channel names which we had configured. So if you remember, I had already configured ops team, and then we had also configured admin. So that's why we see all of these channels here. Okay, now I'm going to save it. Okay, so you can click on save and you can give a dashboard name. So let's call it demo alert. And I'm going to keep it in general folder. If you want to change it to any other folder, you can do that. So in this case, I'm just going to keep it in general folder and click on save. And here now you can see our first panel, which is showing a CPU utilization, but right now CPU utilization has not reached above a threshold. That's why we don't see anything as of now. Okay. Now, before I go on and increase some of the load on this server, I will also want to show you one more panel, which is alert list. Okay, so I'm going to select alert list panel and then we can click on apply. So right now you saw, as soon as I clicked on alert list, we started to get alert. But basically we started seeing all the alerts from different dashboards as well. So that's basically the functionality of alerts panel. It is going to show you all the alerts at one place. And if there is no alerts, it is just going to be blank. Let me change this, the title, to let's call it all alerts and click on apply. And now whenever we have any alerts coming from any of the dashboards or any of the panel, that's going to be shown here. Okay, so now I'm going to increase load on this server. So this is the server which is IT Panther 02. On this one, I'm going to increase or going to start some of the process which consumes more CPU. And then we should be able to see certain spike in the CPU utilization. Okay, so now slowly we should start seeing spike in CPU utilization. And let me also change the refresh interval to every 5 seconds. And let's make it last 15 minutes. Okay, so now you can see we already started getting, the CPU utilization has shot up, and we already started getting one alert, and right now it is changed to pending state. Okay, so this is what I was telling you. So first time when alerts came, it changed it to pending state. And also this is kind of annotation which is available. So now let's say if you want to, when you hover your mouse cursor to this arrow, it is going to show you what was the CPU utilization at that point of time. So this is the starting point of time. At this time, the alert status is shown as pending. So once it continues to be at this threshold or continues to crossing this threshold for 2 minutes or more, in that case it is going to be changed into alerting. Okay, so this is the alerts which is coming from this panel, and then we have these alerts which are coming from different dashboards which I had already configured. And while it is calculating, or it is waiting for, you know, continuous threshold for 2 minutes or more, let's click on this annotation. And once you click on this annotation, you will notice there is a small pen or pencil icon here. So you can click on this pencil icon, and then you will have an option to provide more description here. Okay, so in this case, let's say you want to provide more description about this alert. For example, I'm going to call it testing of Redis load is going on, which resulted in high CPU utilization. Okay, so whatever reason which you had, you can put those reason here, so, and save it. So next time when someone is going to see that, or when someone is going to hover over that alert, in that case it is going to show them these remarks. Okay, so from a management point of view, or from operational team, or from monitoring team point of view, they are going to hover over the mouse here, and then they'll be able to know the reason. Now you see, after the 2 minutes interval, we have got another alert which is in red color, and also here the CPU utilization panel alert has changed to alerting. Okay, so this is the time when all the emails should have started triggered, and you would have got email in your email box. Okay, now as soon as this alert, or whenever CPU utilization goes down, it is going to change it to green again. So I will show you by killing this process. So whatever process I was running which increased the load, I have just killed that process, and now CPU utilization should start to go down. So let's notice that, and in the meantime we can also put remarks in this annotation, and I'm going to call it Redis load test is still going on. It is going to finish in a couple of minutes. Okay, so that's it. And now when someone is moving their mouse cursor around these annotation, they should be able to see all the remarks which we have set up here. Now you see CPU utilization has already started going down, or it has started going less than 40%. So after 2 minutes, we should be able to see this changing to green again. Okay, so that's the indication that alert has gone and it's no longer available. So typically what you do is you have one alert panel which is like going to be on top of any other graph, or you have alert window which is like the focus point for the monitoring team. You have different dashboards configured. You can have like hundreds of dashboard configured which is sending alerts, and then you have only one alerting dashboard which you hand over to monitoring team, and they are the one who are just going to focus on alerting tab. So whenever they have alert, maybe they need to start communicating to the relevant team in order to, you know, so they start working and fixing those alerts. And one more thing here is, if you click on add panel, you will see something called convert to row. Okay, so once you do convert to row, you will have an option of moving all of whatever the panels available here to a kind of expandable and collapsible row. So I'm going to click on convert to row, and now you see we have this something called row title. So I'm going to click on settings and going to change the name from row titles to, let's call it high level or let's just call it dashboard 01. Click on update. Now you see dashboard 01 here, and also you see this arrow. So if you click here, it is going to collapse everything, and if you click here again, it is going to expand everything. So you can have like many number of panels created here, and then you can arrange them in row panels. So if somebody wants to focus only on a particular row panel, they can go there and click, and they'll be able to see more details of that row panel. By the way, in the meantime, as you saw, now since the CPU utilization has gone down, we also got a new alert which is in green color, and it is showing that CPU utilization has become okay now. And also the little heart symbol which we had, now it has turned to a green heart symbol. So that's how you handle alerts in Grafana. So in this session, we will learn how we can set up Grafana and Telegram alerts. So in order to configure Telegram, you again need to go to alerting and then go to notification channels. Once you go to notification channel, you can add a new channel by clicking new channel. Now here, let's give a name of, let's call it Grafana Telegram Test. And in the type, you need to change it to Telegram. Now, if you just see here, there is an option to include images. If you include images, whenever you are breaching certain threshold, that image is going to get rendered from Grafana and going to be sent on alert as well. So if we want to enable this on previous version, which is like version 6.6 and below, you could just enable it and then it would have started sending image. But in Grafana 7, image rendering is not by default available, so we need to install image rendering plugin. So if you, when you enable it and you click on this link, you are going to be taken to a Grafana image rendering plugin. So here, if you scroll down, you have an option of using or installing Grafana image rendering using Grafana CLI plugin. So I have copied it and I'm going to install it on our Grafana server. Okay. Okay, we need sudo access in this case because we are not logged in as a root user. So either I can switch to root user by doing sudo space su space hyphen, or second approach is, I'm just going to delete this. Second approach is you can use sudo in the beginning and then you can copy paste same command again. Okay, so I have put sudo in the beginning and rest of the command is same. Hit enter and then it should be able to install this plugin. Okay, so it is saying now it has successfully installed. However, we also need to restart Grafana. Okay, whenever we are actually doing any of the plugin installation, we need to restart Grafana. So let me do that as well. So there are two approaches. Either you can use systemctl or you can use the command which is given here. So in this case, I'm just going to use this command which I have typed, hit enter, and then you should be able to restart Grafana. Now you can check the status again by changing restart to status, hit enter, and if Grafana is in active status, it means everything is okay. Now you can go back to Grafana screen again and refresh. Okay, so we actually came back to whatever we had done so far, that is lost because we did not save it. Anyways, we just now begin again. We can type the name, which is, let's call it Grafana Telegram Test. And here in the type, we need to change it to Telegram. And now in the include image, you see now it has been turned on and we don't get any warning, which means Now whatever plugin we had installed is successfully working. Now this is the important things. Here if you see in Telegram API settings, we need to provide bot API token and also we need to provide chat ID. So what are these two things and how we will get it? So for that we need to log in into Telegram. So I'm logged into Telegram using web interface, but you can log into your mobile as well. And then you need to search for, there is something called bot father. Okay, so you need to search for bot father, and using this bot father you will be able to create your own bot. Okay, so I have already followed these steps. I'll show you what we need to do. So we need to go to bot father, and then as soon as you go to bot father you need to type /start. Once you do that, bot father is going to give you some list of available options. Okay, here you can see we have got automatic reply from bot father with so many options. So now we want to create a new bot, so you can click on new bot, and once you click on new bot your response is going to be sent something like this /new bot, and then again bot father will reply and it is going to ask you what is the name you want to give to this new bot which you are creating. So in this case we are giving it a name of Grafana admin, and again then bot father is going to ask you what is the username you want to give to this bot. So username also we need to postfix _bot. So in this case I have just used the same name and I have just used _bot. So our bot username is grafanaadmin_bot. And after that you will get congratulations message along with the token. Okay, this token is very important, and this is the token which we need to provide in. So this is the token which we need to provide when you are configuring or when you are integrating basically Telegram with Grafana. So I am copying it and I am going to use it here. Okay, and now in the chat ID we need to provide the chat ID. Or now let's say if you want to send all the alerts to one of the groups, okay, in that case you need to create a group first. Let's say you already have any group created, in that case you can add your bot which is having user ID of grafanaadmin_bot to that group, and then whenever Grafana is sending alert to that bot it is going to go in that group. Okay, so I'll show you how we can do that. I'm going to create a group and let's add grafanaadmin_bot in this group, and let's give this group name, let's call it Grafana Ops Telegram group. Okay, so that's the name of the Telegram group. In your case you may already have any existing Telegram group and you just want to enable alerting. In that case you must add this new bot which we have created and make that part of that group. Okay, so let's click on create group, and now we can see group is created. In this group if you see we have two members. Okay, one is Grafana admin. So this member is very important. If you do not have grafanaadmin_bot or basically whatever bot you created, that should be part of the group. So once you do that, now you need chat ID, right? You saw here we need to provide chat ID. So to provide chat ID, there is basically something called an API. Okay, this is the URL of that API, and in there if you see we have get updates. So what it does is whatever your bot's token ID, you need to provide that token ID here. And then you need to basically use this complete URL and just replace this token ID with your token ID and hit enter, and then you are going to get all the response here. Okay, and that response is basically going to contain the chat ID. So I'll show you how we can do that. So once you add a new member to the group, okay, once you add bot to the existing group, you also need to send some dummy message. So I'm just going to say hi, and let's send this message to this Grafana bot basically. Hit enter, okay, and now I have already copy pasted this token, okay, and I have already pasted this token here on this URL, and after that I'm going to hit enter, and now you see whatever group we had created, which is called Grafana Ops underscore Telegram underscore group, okay, this is the message, or basically this is the group name. Okay, now here you see something beginning with ID. So this is the ID which is chat, which is basically chat ID which we need to provide. So I'm just zooming it a bit, and this is the response which we have received from Get Updates API, and this is the chat ID which we need to copy and paste here in the chat ID. Now once you do that, now you can click on send test in order to see whether it is working properly or not. And let's go back to Telegram group again, which we had created. Okay, so the group name is Grafana Ops underscore Telegram underscore group. So right now you see we do not have any alerts from Grafana. I'm now going to test here by clicking on send test. And now you see it is saying test notification is sent. We see the green signal. Let's go to our Telegram group again. And here you can see we have received an alert. Okay, so now whenever we are setting up any alert on any dashboard, we can use this name, which is Grafana Telegram Test. Okay, so let's save this. This configuration is fine. Let's save this. And then let's create, or let's go to one of the existing dashboards. So in this case, let's go to demo alerts dashboard. Now if you remember, previously we had created a panel which is having alert, and whenever basically CPU utilization is going to get high, this is going to send an alert. However, previously in the alerts we had just added email alerts, we hadn't added Telegram alerts. So in this case I'm just going to click on this title and going to edit this, and then we'll go to alerts, and then I will add Telegram alert as well. So if you remember the name for that channel which we had configured, that is called Grafana Telegram Test. So I have added that, and now we can click on apply. Okay, so right now you see CPU utilization is down. So let's wait for few more seconds, and then I'm going to run some workload which is going to basically create a spike in the CPU utilization. Okay, so now we see everything is normal, CPU utilization is very less. So now I'm going to create some workload which will basically be resulting in high CPU utilization. So we should be able to see a spike in CPU utilization from this time onwards. And once it reaches above that threshold, first time we are again going to see that yellow line, which is kind of indication that value has reached beyond threshold. And once the same situation, you know, continues for 2 minutes, because we have set up 2 minutes in our alert query, I just want to show you again. So here in the alert you can see we had put it 2 minutes. So once the same situation continues for 2 minutes, then in that case it is going to create a new line with red, something like which has previously been done. Okay, and this is the time when you see the red line, this is the time when actually the alerts get triggered. So that's the time when we should be able to see a new message arriving in this group, Telegram group. Now you can see we have already got one yellow line. So this is the indication that alert has reached, basically we CPU utilization has reached threshold. And the first alert, as I told you, gets created with a pending status. So here you can see the status is showing as pending. And once we have this continuing for 2 minutes, then in that case it is going to change from pending to alerting, and that's the time when we'll be seeing a new message arriving here. So right now, if you see, we do not have any new message in this group because status is still showing as pending. So let's wait until it changes to alerting, and then we are going to go back to Telegram group and see what is the kind of alerting which we have received. Alright, so now we can see we have a new line appearing in red color, and also status has changed to alerting. So I'm going to go to Grafana group, and now you can see we have received a new alert here on our Telegram group.
Plugins.
So in this session we will discuss about plugins, and we are going to understand what are the different types of plugins available and what are the different methods of installing plugins. Okay, so now to begin with plugin, first thing I'm just going to click on add panel, and then I'm going to go to add new panel. And here if you notice on the visualizations, we have around 10 to 12 visualizations available. Okay, and we do not see many other visualization types, such as let's say pie chart. Okay, so let's say if you have a requirement to make visualizations using pie chart or any other visualization which you do not see here, then you can search those plugins, because most of the charts or visualizations are already created by community and it is available on Grafana plugins market store. So I'm just going to go back, and we don't really need to save it. So now if you go to configuration, you have an option of plugins. So here I'm going to click on plugins, and this is asking whether we want to save the current dashboard. I just want to discard it, we don't need to save anything. So here you see list of plugins which we already have available. Okay, and now let's say if you want to add a new plugin, in that case you can click here, which is showing find more plugins on grafana.com. So I'm going to click here, and once you have internet, it is going to take you to this tab. Okay, basically this is the page from where you can see all the Grafana plugins. Okay, I'm just going to go back, I will open it in a new tab. So we have Grafana opened in one tab, so I'm just going to right click here and going to select open link in new tab. Okay, now here one thing you will notice, there are so many plugins. There is plugins available almost for all the needs. However, one important thing to notice here is you will see most of the plugins are marked as open source, and there are some of the plugins which are marked as enterprise. For example, if you see here, Amazon TimeStream is marked as enterprise. And also if you notice, like AppDynamics is also marked as enterprise. So these are the plugins. If you want these plugins, then you need to basically have an enterprise version of Grafana, because these are the ones which are not available for or not available as an open source. Okay, so in this case, let's say I just want a pie chart panel. So in this case, pie chart, we can see pie chart doesn't have enterprise written over here, so which means it is openly available to use. So I'm going to click on pie chart, and once you do that, you are going to be presented with the screen which is going to be talking about overview of the plugin. So in this we do not have much documentation about this plugin, but you will see for some of the plugins there is very good documentation available, so you can read those before you install any plugins. Okay, so now there is one method of installing Grafana plugin by using Grafana CLI. So in this case we can just simply copy this and we can paste this on the Grafana server, and again we need to be root, so I'm going to type sudo in the beginning. So once I hit enter, this is going to get installed. Okay, so that's one way, and this will only work if you have internet connected on the server. Okay, so wherever server you want to install this plugin, you must have internet available. Because what this is going to do is, this is going to go to that Grafana plugin store and going to download this plugin and then install it for you. So the other approach is, you can download these plugins using offline method, and then you can move this from, let's say, using WinSCP from your local machine to the server, and then you can follow the steps mentioned here in order to install the plugin. And again, whenever we install any plugin, we need to restart Grafana. So here you see command of restarting Grafana. So in this case, it is very simple. I'm just going to use this Grafana CLI method. So let's go to server, and here you see we already have the command pasted. So I'm just going to hit enter and it should proceed with the installation. So you saw the plugin was very small, so it has very quickly installed this plugin. Now we need to restart Grafana. So this is the command which I'm going to use in order to restart Grafana. Again, we need to run it as a root user, so I didn't run it as a root user, that's why it was asking for password. Now I have put sudo in the beginning, and now we should be able to restart this. Now if you want to see the status, we need to replace restart with status, and now we can see Grafana is already active. So in this case, we should be able to now able to see new plugin available here. So right now we see that new plugin is not showing here. That is because we have not refreshed this web page. So I'm going to refresh. And now you can see this pie chart is available. Okay, now also we can go back to our dashboard, and there we can create a new panel and we can start using this new visualization. So I'm going to click on add panel, then under here in the visualization we can see now pie chart is available. Okay, so let's create a quick visualization using pie chart. So in this case, again I'm going to use our InfluxDB data store, and I want to see CPU utilization. And let's say we want to see usage system. Okay, so right now you see we have only one item. That's because we have not grouped by on any of the items. So if we group by based on CPU or based on host, then we will see the data changing here. So I have grouped by based on CPU. So in my machine I have two CPU cores, so CPU 0 and CPU 1, these are the two cores which we have available, and here it is showing the average utilization of each of the CPU cores. Now if you want max utilization, you can change here from mean to max. So I'm just going to remove it, and I'm going to select in the selectors, I'm going to select max. Again, as you remember, if you want to change here, if you just want to see the CPU number rather than seeing this complete function, so you can again use tag underscore CPU, and it should be able to show you now only the CPUs. Guys, one thing you should be aware of, whenever you install any plugin, just make sure you read about that plugin carefully, and that whatever plugin you are going to install, especially if you are installing on a production system, just make sure that is, you know, authenticated plugin and it is going to work in your environment. If possible, test it in your test environment before installing it directly in a production environment. In this session, we will learn how we can create users in Grafana. And also we'll be discussing about what are the various roles you can provide to users, and based on that roles, what are the things or operations they'll be able to perform in Grafana. So first thing is, if you want to create a user, you must have admin role. If you do not have an admin role, you will not be able to create users in Grafana. So I'm logged in with my default admin user, and then I'm going to go to server admin, and here you can see the option of users. So click on users, and then here you can see a button which is called new user. So I'm going to click on new user, and here you need to provide details of user. So let's call it Smith, and email I'm going to give smith@itpanther.com, and username also I'm going to keep Smith. Password also you can provide whatever password you want. So in this case I'm just going to keep Smith. And then you can click on create user. As soon as you click on create user, you should be able to see that user is created successfully. Now, in order to see what is the role which has been provided to this user, you need to click on this user. So by default, whenever a user is created, it has a role of viewer. So you can see right now this user is having a role of viewer. Now you can click on change role and you can see what are the other roles available. So you can see there is a role of editor and admin. So we don't want to make all the users admin. Okay, so it is always a good idea you make most of the users just as a viewer, because if everyone is having ability to make changes in Grafana, that is not going to be a good thing from management point of view. And you can give viewer role to someone who just needs to look at the dashboard and needs to monitor them. Typically it is going to be the role which you give to L0 in your organization, and they are the one who are responsible for monitoring different type of dashboards, and they are the one who are going to manage all the alerts. Now in this case I'm just going to leave it as it is, so let's leave it viewer. And now here if you see, we also have ability to update any of the information. So let's say once you created the user and later on you wanted to change the name, so you have the ability to change the name of that user or email ID, or basically you can change all the user information here. And also here in the sessions you can see from which all devices the user has logged in. So right now this is a new user, so that's why we don't see anything in the sessions. Now I'm going to open a new browser, and here we are going to log in with the newly created user. So once we log in, we will see what is the difference between an admin user and a view only user. So first thing when you notice, you know, as soon as you log in as a viewer, is that on the left side you had very limited set of options available. If I go back to my admin user, so here you see you have options such as explore, alerting, configuration and server admin. These are the options which are not available to a user with viewer role. The only option available here is dashboard, so he can go to manage, and then this user can see all the different types of dashboards available. So demo alerts is the one which we had created previously. So user with view only right can see all the dashboards, and if he wants to modify any of the panel and user clicks on title, he will not be having an option of edit. Okay, so that's the view only rights. Now let's change this user permission to editor and let's see what is the difference which happens. So now I'm going to change the role to editor, and now I'm going to save this. So once we save this, screen also got refreshed, and that's the reason now you can see in the session we have new entries available. So this is the IP address from which this user logged in, and this is the browser from which the user was logged in. And also you get the information of operating system. Now let's say in case you want the user to log out, okay, so as an admin you have the ability to force log out the user. So if you see here right now I'm still logged in, so I'm going to click on force logout and going to click on confirm logout. So now this user is going to be logged out from here. So you see automatically this user got logged out. Since now we have also updated the rights to editor, so now we will log in again and we will see what is the difference in the user interface now.
So as the name suggests, as an editor, there will be some extra options available, which you can now see on the left side. So we have an option of explore, and then there is an option of alerting. And also now if you go to manage dashboards, and let's say we select one of the dashboards, which is demo alerts. And now if we click on any of the panel, if we click on the title, we now going to have an option of edit. So a user with an editorial right will be having ability to edit any dashboard, change thresholds, or perform any kind of visualization action. This is the kind of role which you can give to a developer, or basically Grafana visualization developer in your organization. Now again, if I go back to admin console and I refresh the screen, you'll be able to see I'm going to see the information of this user and whatever machine the user is logged in from. So now if the user is logged into multiple devices, you will be able to see all those sessions here. And if you want the user to be logged out from all the devices, then you have ability to click on force logout from all devices. So this is going to make sure that user is logged out from all the devices. So that's the basic difference between different types of users and roles available in Grafana. So based on the kind of roles and responsibility performed by a particular user in your organization, you can provide the rights accordingly. In this session, we will learn about tabular visualization type in Grafana. So I'm going to click on Add Panel, and I'll be selecting table in the visualization. Now here in the query, I'm going to change it to InfluxDB Demo Data Source. And in the from, I'm going to choose AutoGen. And in the measurement, I'm going to use disk. Let's say we want to see disk utilization for all the mount points. So in that case, again in the field value, we need to change it to used percentage, because I want to see the percent of utilization for each of the mount points. Now in the group by, we need to select path. Okay, so path will give us each of the mount points. So now you see, as soon as we selected path, we can see a drop down being added here with the option of selecting a path. Now let's say you don't want disk.mean to be shown here, you just want the path. So in that case, you can use alias by field, and here you can use $tag_path. And what this will do is, now you can see here in the drop down, it has been changed to only the available mount points. Now let's say if you had a requirement like this, in that case, this fits okay for you, then you can leave this drop down as it is. That's number one. Okay, and in this case, I'm also going to change the interval. So I'm going to change the interval to, let's say, every 5 minutes. Okay, now, however, in my case, let's say I don't want data to be like this. I want both or all the available options here to be shown as a new column. Okay, so with that, what I mean is, I want a column which is having total disk percentage available for slash mount point, and then the other column which is having total disk utilization percentage available for slash boot slash EFL. So now to do that, you need to click on transform and then scroll down, and here in the add field from calculation, you need to click on select. So once you do that, you will notice whatever options available under this drop down, it is going to be changed into columns. So that's what I want. So I'm going to click on select here. Now you can see we have both the mount points. So slash is a mount point, and then slash boot slash EFL is another mount point. So I can see the utilization for slash mount point around 1205 was 66%, and utilization for boot EFL was 5.5%, and in total it rounds up to 72% utilization. Now let's see, on the right side you will see an option of field, which is next to panel. So once you click on field, you have an option of
doing the column alignments. Now whatever alignment you do here, it is going to be reflected on the table level. So with that, what I mean is, let's say I want to change the alignment to center. So once I click on center, you will notice all the value or all the columns has been center aligned. And if I click on right, all the fields are going to be right aligned in this case. Now let's switch it back to center. And now here in the cell display mode, you see we have something like color text, color background, gradient gauge, LCD gauge, and JSON view. Now let's say you select color text. In that case, you see whatever color or whatever you selected basically going to be applied to all the values. Now let's say you don't want to have this behavior. You want to format each column one by one. Okay, so we will see how we do that. Before that, I just want to show you this gradient gauge. So if we click on gradient gauge, now you can see our values for all the fields are showing in a kind of gradient gauge visualization which we had. Okay, now however, let's say we don't want this to be for all the columns, we want gradient gauge only for total column. So I will show you how we can do that. In this case, again, I'm going to change it to auto. And also I don't want center alignment, so I'm just going to change it to auto. And now we need to go to overrides. Okay, so overrides is the option where you will be able to change these things. So I'm going to click on add override. So here you will notice we have an option of filter by field. So I'm going to select filter by field. And here I'm going to select the field. So in this case, let's say I want to select field of total. And now we will click on add override property. And here in the cell display mode, I'm going to select gradient gauge. Okay, and now let's also click on add override property again. And let's add threshold. Okay, so let's say when we have anything going over 70, we want that to be shown into red. So I'm going to change this value to 70. Okay, so now you can see how data has changed here and how the colors and all has changed here. So this is about this total column. Now let's say we want to center align this slash boot slash EFL column. So in this case, you can add another override and you can again click on filter by field, and here you can select slash boot slash EFL. Now here you will be having option of column alignment. So in the column alignment, you can select center. And you will notice that only this column has been affected. And now we can save it. And now you have table visualization ready. So in this session, we are going to discuss about using stat visualization. And we are going to have a bit of deep dive into formatting and some of the different options available with stat visualization. So as you can see here, I have already created a stat visualization and this is what data looks like. So this is giving me total disk utilization for all the three servers and for all the available mount points. So you can see I have server which is called IT Panther 02, IT Panther 03 and IT Panther 04. And also on each of the server I have two mount points. So that's why total I get 6 blocks. And also you see we are getting percentage and below that we are getting kind of spark line. So now let's see how we can create this visualization. So I'm going to click on add panel and I'm going to add stat visualization. Okay, now here in the data source I'm going to select InfluxDB demo and I'm going to change it to disk, and also I'm going to here select total used percentage. Okay, so right now you're seeing we are getting a single value. That's because we have not added group by. So in the group by, now I'm going to add host, and also we want each of the mount points, so I'm also going to add path. So now you can see we have total 6 values. And if you notice here in the name, we are getting functions. Okay, so we want to get rid of it. So I'm going to add tag underscore host and also going to add tag underscore path. Now data has, or you can see the title has improved a bit. Now here panel title, I don't want any title, so I'm just going to remove this. So if you remove this, there will not be any visible title. And just below that there is an option of transparent. So if you enable transparency, you can see you will not have any kind of borderline or grid which was shown when you disable this. So in some of the scenario, it looks more visually appealing when you have this turned on. So in this case, I think it's going to look better if we have it turned off. We'll see both the cases. Now if I scroll down here, I'm going to get many different options related to the orientation and color mode and so on. So now here in this case, you see all of the values are looking in green color. So one thing is, I'm just going to change the background. So in the color mode, I'm going to select background. Okay, now let's say we want to have all these values shown in a different color. So in that case, we need to add threshold. So I'm going to go to field, and here in the threshold, I'm going to add some of the threshold. So let's say all the values from base until 6, we want to be in a different color. And then anything which is around 27, we want it to be in a different color. And then we also going to add another threshold, which is 28. And then I am going to add one more threshold, which is 60 and above. Okay, so now you see all of these blocks have different colors based on the threshold color which is given here. And again, if you want to change the color, for example, let's say you want to change this color, then you can click on this color and you can pick either one of the available colors. Let's say if I want to change it to purple, I can do that. Or if you want some custom color, then you have an option of specifying custom color here or selecting custom color from here. So in this case, this looks fine, so we can just go ahead with this. And now again, I'm back to panel. So here we will see what happens if we change the orientation from auto to horizontal. So basically, when you select auto, it has by default is giving you vertical orientation. Now if you want this data to be shown into horizontal orientation, then you can do that. So this is how horizontal orientation is going to look like. In this case, what I feel is that it is not visually appealing. So either you can just stick to vertical, or you can just click auto, which is basically Grafana is going to choose the best possible visualization for you. Now you can click on apply, and then it is going to be shown here. Now again, you have an option to minimize or maximize. Now one thing you can notice, the one which we created just now is having absolute value, and the one which was previously created is having percentage value. So now let's say you want to show percentage here as well. So in that case, you can click on this title again and click on edit. And now once you go to field, you have something called unit. Again, based on the kind of data you have, for example, if you are trying to show sales value, in that case, you can select unit to be, you know, kind of dollars or money related. In this case, however, I'm just going to select it. To percentage. So in order to do that, you can just start typing unit, and in the unit, once you type P or PER, you are going to see the value of percentage. So in this case, I'm going to select percentage, and now you can see value has changed from absolute to percentage. If you had any other unit, you could do that. So if you have this, you know, you are showing some sales or revenue, then you can select currency. So in this case, let's say if it had been sales, then I could have selected dollars. However, in our case, we know this is a disk utilization, and it is more appropriate if we are selecting percentage unit. And then you can save, and or if you just want to see it, you could have just clicked on apply. In this session, we will learn about Grafana variables. Now, variables are very useful when you have problem statements, such as you want to make a selection of few subsets in when you have large amount of data available. So for example, in this case, let's assume you had around 20 servers, and out of those 20 servers, you could have seen, like, you know, hundreds of mount points combining all of those 20 servers. Now let's say if we are interested only on couple of servers, then how can we give end user an option to select only the selected servers, and then he can see the details of only those selected servers? So now, in order to do that, we have something called variables in Grafana. So to enable variables, you can click here on settings. Okay, so you need to click on dashboard settings. Do not go here in the configuration, you need to select it from here in the dashboard settings. Now once you click on that, you will be noticing there are several options available. So from these options on the left side, we need to click on variables. Now under the variables, click on add variable. Now here you can assign a name to this variable, and I will show you where that variable name is going to appear. So let's call it hosts list. And now the type of variable which we are going to define is a query. So basically what I'm going to do is I have a query which is going to give me list of all the hosts. Okay, so notice here, this query is going to work only on InfluxDB. If you are using MySQL or any other database, or basically any other data sources, in that case you need equivalent query in that data source. So let me show you what is the output of this query in InfluxDB. So I'm going to log in to the server where we have installed InfluxDB. And here, if you want to interact with InfluxDB in command line mode, you need to type influx, hit enter. Now you need to specify which is the database or schema which you want to connect to. So in this case, we want to connect to Telegraph schema. So I'm going to say use space Telegraph. And then you can paste this query. So what this query is doing is, in terms of InfluxDB, basically this is going to show me all the values which are available under host key. So we know in host key we have three servers, which is IT Panther 02, 03 and 04. Okay, so that's why I'm going to use this query. Now right now you notice here at the bottom we do not have any option available. Okay, so now as soon as I'm going to paste the query, you will see the output of that query appearing here. Okay, so before we do that, we also need to make sure we select the correct data source. So in this case, we want to connect to InfluxDB demo. This is the one which we had created. And in the query, I'm going to paste the query. So now notice, once you paste the query and click anywhere else, this is going to get evaluated. And now here in the preview of values, you are going to see the values. So as we could see here, we had three values, IT Panther 0, 2, 3 and 4. So now here in the variable values, we can see those output. So for now, I'm just going to click on add, and then I will show you how it is going to look like in the dashboard. So once you click on add, this is how it is going to show here on the variable screen. Now you can click on save dashboard, and then you can go back and you'll be able to notice a change. Now here you see, this is the name which we had given. So we had given host list, and here we can see list of all the available hosts. Okay. Now, let's say if I select ITPanther 03, in that case, it should have shown me data here only for ITPanther 03. But right now, we do not see that happening. The reason is that we also need to use this variable name in the where clause. So I'm going to edit this panel. So I'm going to click on edit. And then here in our query, we need to make use of this variable which we had defined. Okay, so in the where clause now I'm going to add host. And here in the tag value, we need to specify this variable. So you notice this variable has started coming now once you defined variable. Previously, this was not available. So now I'm going to select this. And now you can see as soon as we defined or added this variable in our where clause, now we can see based on the selection, our data set is changing. So if I had selected ITPanther 02, this output is changing. And now we are seeing only hosts related to ITPanther 02. So I'm going to click on apply. And now let's see how it is going to look like. So as an end user, which is having only view only facility, like, you know, your monitoring team, they are the one, they'll be able to make a selection on here. And based on that, they'll be able to see the values changing here. Now let's say in this case, user is having option of selecting only one server. Now let's say we want to select multiple server. So what is the change we had to do? In that case, you can go again to dashboard settings. You can go again to the variables and you have an option to update your existing variables. So in this case, this variable is here. So I'm going to click on this variable. And then here, see in the multi value, right now it is disabled. So by default, it remains disabled. Now we are going to enable this. Once we enable this, user will have an option to select multiple values. Now once you did that, click on update. And now click on save dashboard again. Or if you don't want to save dashboard, you can just come back here. So now in this case, you see now this has changed from single selection to a multiple checkbox. Now I have an option to select, let's say I can select ITPanther 02 and I can select ITPanther 04. So once I do that, now you see the value has changed here and it is showing me details of two servers. It is showing me details of ITPanther 02 and ITPanther 04 servers. Now consider one more scenario. Let's say you had a list of around 20 or 30 servers. And you wanted to see all the, you know, server details. In that case, it is very inconvenient to select all the hosts one by one. So for example, in this case, if I want to see all the three hosts, it is very inconvenient to select all the three hosts one by one. However, if I select all the three hosts, I'm able to see all the values. Now it had been nicer if we would have something called all in the beginning. So if we had selected all, it would have shown us all the values. So we can do that in Grafana. And to do that again, we need to go to dashboard settings and go to that variable which you have defined. Click again on the variable definition. And now here next to multi-value, you see an option which is called include all option. So once you enable that, it is going to show you a value which is called all. And once you select that, you'll be able to see all the hosts. Okay, so again in the preview of value, you can see there is one more option has been enabled which is called all. So now let's click on update. Click on save dashboard and then I'm going to go back. And now if we select here, now we can see we have an option which is called all. So let me unselect everything and we are just going to select all. So now you can see even if we select all, now we are able to see all the host value. If we want to select only one host, we could do that. So in this case, once I change to ITPanther 02, I see value of or data related to only ITPanther 02. So let's change it to all again. and now we can see this. Now let's say if you don't want to show this name, you just wanted to show the value, so you can do that as well. In that case, you can click on dashboard setting, you can go to the variable again and click on variable definition. Now you have an option of hide, so in the hide you can click on label. Okay, so in that case, whatever label you had given, that is going to be hidden. However, in this case, please notice what is going to be the result. Okay, just make a note that we have selected label in hide, and let's see what happens. Okay, so now you see here, we do not have label in the beginning. Now we see only the values. So user can make a selection of the value, and based on that, they'll be able to see the options available here. Now let's say rather than seeing the default value, we wanted something, we still want label, but we want to give some logical name to that label. So in that case, we can do that as well. So I'm going to change this hide to blank, and in the label, let's call it all servers. Okay, now let's click on update and click on save dashboard. Go back, and now we should be able to see all servers. So this is the one which looks more logical and it looks more better. So now you saw how we created variables using InfluxDB as a data source. Now let's say you had another data source, which is MySQL in this case. So how we could use that? So everything else is basically going to stay the same. You're still going to click on new variable, and here you are going to give some logical name. So let's call it MySQL hosts, and I'm going to leave it to query. And in the data source, we need to select the data source which is pointing to MySQL. So in this case, we have matrix data source. This is the one which is pointing to MySQL. Okay, now let's say I'm going to go to the server where we have MySQL installed, and I'm going to connect to MySQL. I will show you how it is going to look like here, and then we'll be using the same query there in Grafana. So if you remember, under the GrafanaDB database, we had created a table which is called matrix. And now we are going to see what is the value available there. So let's click on, or let's query using select star from matrix. And you can see it is giving us so much data. And this is the column which we are interested in. The name of this column is host. So I'm going to say select host from matrix. And now if you see, it is giving us so many records. Now we don't want so many records, we just want distinct hosts. So in this case, I'm going to select distinct host from matrix, and now I get only the host names. Now notice, in this case we had only two names available, that's why it is showing us only two results. So I'm now going to use this query and going to paste here in the query. Again, notice in the preview right now we do not have anything available. So once I paste the query here and click on the blank area, now this query is going to get evaluated, and now we are able to see the values available here. Again, you can enable multi-value, you can include all options. So whatever we have done using InfluxDB, all those options are available with all the different data sources. So now once I click on add, I should be able to now see that in the dashboard as well. So I'm going to go back, and here now we can see MySQL host also coming here. Now again, we need to use this in one of our queries, and then only it is going to reflect. Now in all our query, we have just used InfluxDB data source, so this doesn't make sense in my case. However, in your case, if you are using visualization using MySQL database, in that case, you can make use of this variable. In this session, we are going to see some of the other advanced options available while we are configuring any visualization. So let's click on add panel. And in this case, I'm going to select data source of InfluxDB demo. And in the visualization, we have selected graph. So let's create a query in order to see what is the CPU utilization on one server, which is IT Panther 02, and we will see a CPU utilization for each of the cores. So in the server which we have two CPU cores available. So let's say we are interested to see the CPU utilization of those cores. So here in the from, I'm going to select AutoGen. In the measurement, I'm going to select CPU. And now here in the select, I'm going to change it to usage system. And here I'm going to change, rather than average, let's say I'm interested in seeing the max utilization. So I'm going to change the selector to max. And also I'm going to add a group by. In group by, I'm going to select tag CPU. And then this is going to show us the value of all the available CPUs. So now you can see we have CPU 0, we have CPU 1. And what we also have is CPU total. So first thing is, I don't want to see this CPU.max CPU, these things. So I'm just going to use alias by, which is tag underscore CPU. So this will get rid of all those things. Now we can see only CPU 0, 1 and CPU total. The other thing which I don't want here is, I don't want to see CPU total. So when you have multiple series and you are not interested in seeing data of one of the series, in that case you can apply filters, and filters are to be applied in where clause. So in this case I need to add a filter on CPU, and I'm going to change it to not equal to, because I don't want to see CPU total. So in this case I'm selecting CPU not equal to, and in the select tag value we can change it to CPU total. Now you can see we don't see data related to CPU total. Now here on the panel, if you see, we are seeing dots, we don't see a connected line. That is because here in the null values we need to select connected. Okay. Now we can start going one by one option and start seeing what are the other available options. So in this case, you are already aware of all of these options which we have also discussed in the past. So now we can discuss about our tooltip. So whenever you move your cursor here on this panel, you see whenever you keep on cursor on any of the series, it shows you information about both the series. So here you, in the output, you can see it is showing you CPU 0 as well as CPU 1. Now let's say you are only interested in seeing the value of the highlighted series. In that case, you can change the mode from all series to single. Now notice when I hover over mouse to CPU 1 series, in that case I am seeing data only for CPU 1. And when I hover over to this green series, or which is CPU 0, in that case I see data only for CPU 0. Again, let's change it to all series. So when you do all series, you get for both. Now you can also decide on what, when you have selected multiple series, you can decide whether you want to see the data in ascending or descending order. In that case you can change here sort order from increasing or decreasing. So let's say if I keep it increasing, in that case you can see CPU 0 is coming on CPU 0 is coming on top, because CPU 0 is basically, the value of CPU 0 is less and the value of CPU 1 is more. Now if I change it to decreasing, in that case if I hover over my mouse here, now you can see the value of CPU 1 is more, that's why it is coming on top, and the value of CPU 0 is less, that's why it is showing on as a second available option. Okay, so that's how you can sort the order of all of these series values. Again, this is only going to reflect when you are hovering over, because these are under hover tooltip. Now the other important thing here is, let's say you have these two series and you want to change the formatting of one of the series. Okay, let's say the one which is called CPU0, you want a different formatting for this series. Okay, in that case, you can use series overrides. So here in the series overrides, you can click on add series override, and here you need to provide one of the field. So in this case, if you click on this, you are going to get all the available series, and I'm going to select CPU0 because this is the one which we want to override. And now let's change it. Let's say we want to change the line width. Okay, let's say I want to make this series bit thicker. So in that case, I'm going to select line width of 8. So now you can see the green one, which is CPU0, the width of that series has increased. So this is just one effect. If you want to change it to some different effect, you can do that as well. Now notice I'm just going to change it from CPU0 to CPU1. And now you can see CPU0 is having very small width, and CPU1 is now, the width is increased. Okay, so this is very useful when you have multiple series here and then you want to highlight one of the series, or maybe there is some important series and you want to highlight that separately. So in terms of production servers, you can have one of the servers which is very critical. In that case, you can reformat or you can change the formatting of that series. Now let's see about axis. So in axis we have y-axis and x-axis. So whatever you see here is y-axis, and whatever you see here which is like time values, these are called x-axis. Okay, so in some situation, let's say if you don't want to see values available here, which is 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, so you have an option to hide this. Right now you see this show is enabled, so you can click on this to disable it. Now notice here on the left side, you do not see y-axis. So I'm going to enable it again. And now let's say you are interested in seeing value only which is above 20%. Okay, so in that case, you can change the minimum value from auto to 20. So I'm going to change it to 20. And now notice here, you see now this y-axis is beginning with 20. So you don't see any series or any value which is less than 20. So this can be very useful when you want to focus on certain threshold. And again, similarly, you can control max value as well. Now again, on x-axis, you have an option to enable or disable x-axis. So now here you see you are seeing time. Now let's say if I want to disable it, I can disable this show option. And now you can see x series has completely been turned off. I'm going to turn it back on. And now here in the mode, you can see we have time. So that's why here on the X series, we are seeing time. Grafana is actually popularly used for time series kind of analytics. However, let's say if you want to change it from time to any other thing like series, you can do that as well. So let's say we are interested in seeing maximum utilization by CPU. We don't care about the time. We just want to see maximum CPU utilization in last 5 minutes. So here you see we have selected last 5 minutes. And in that case, if I change it to series, it is going to show me data of both the CPUs. Now notice CPU0 is not having any data. The reason being is we have put this Y min. So I'm going to remove this. Now you see for CPU 0, the utilization is around 14, and for CPU 1 utilization is 1.2377. So you see the value here which is showing is very high. The reason for that is when you select mode series, in that case you also need to change the values. So here in the values, by default total has come, that's why we are seeing different or very high CPU utilization here. Okay, so what it has done is for last 5 minutes, whatever data it had collected, it is aggregated that and it is showing the sum of all that. So that's why we see very high value. However, we are interested in the max value here. Okay, so I have changed it to max. Now you can see data is coming properly. So maximum CPU utilization for CPU 1 has gone 59% in last 5 minutes, and for CPU 0 it has gone to 2% in last 5 minutes. Now in this case you see we are not seeing time here on the X series. I'm just going to change it back to time series. And now let's see about legend. So in the legend we have an option to enable or disable it. So you see here you are able to see CPU 0 and CPU 1. These are the one which are called legend. So I'm just going to disable it, and you will notice now the CPU 0 and CPU 1 has gone from here. I'm just going to enable it again. And now if you see the CPU 0 and CPU 1 is just showing next to each other. And if I click on as table and enable this, now you can see this has been changed to a tabular format. So we are seeing CPU 0 and CPU 1 in a different row. So this information is more like a sequential information and it is not coming next to each other. This is very useful when you also want to show min, max and average kind of information. So before that, if you don't like legend to be shown here, you can change it to the right side by enabling to the right option. So once you enable that, legend is going to move to the right side. Now here you notice this panel is showing us the max utilization of both the CPU cores, CPU 0 and CPU 1. However, let's say we are also interested in knowing the other statistics like minimum CPU utilization. So in that case, we can enable minimum value, and for max, we can enable max value. For average, we can enable average. For current, we can enable current. Again, notice here whatever is the minimum utilization which it has observed in last 5 minutes, that's the value which is going to come here. Okay. It is not showing us exactly the minimum utilization of CPU 1. It is just showing the minimum value which it has noticed on this series in last 5 minutes. If you want to see the minimum, utilization, in that case you may have to change here in the query. In the query we are still taking max. So if you want to see the minimum utilization for each of the CPU cores, you have to change in the query. However, the minimum which is shown here is the minimum value in last 5 minutes which is being displayed here. Okay, so don't get confused with the minimum which is shown here and the minimum which is available here in the aggregate function. Okay, again if you want to enable total, you can do that as well. Now notice here, if I have turned off as table, in that case I have the data would have come like next to each other, which is not that much effective, and we can that's why change it to as table, and it looks more better when you have this kind of information shown as a tabular format. Now you have an option to hide the series if there are no values or there are only null values. So you can enable nulls and zeros. In my case, it is not going to make any difference because I don't have any series with only null values or only zeros. So threshold we have already discussed. So other than this, the other important thing is links. So let's say you want to give a link, a reference, so that after seeing this panel, user can take some other action. In that case, you can enable some hyperlinks. So here you can click on the add link and you will get an option to, let's say I want user to log into service management tool, or let's say we want to redirect user to some other documentation page. So you can do that. So in this case, let's call it read more, and here I'm going to call it, so it is just going to be any link. Let's just give google.com, but in actual your environment it should be the link of some service management tool, or you can put the link of some other dashboards. So for example, you can have a summary dashboard and then you can give a link of a detailed dashboard. So once user sees the summary, if he's interested in more details or granular level of details, they can then click on this URL which is going to take them to that dashboard. And also, if you want this URL to be opened in a separate tab in the browser, you can click here on open in new tab, and this is going to enable, whenever user clicks on this URL, it is going to be opened in a new tab. Now we can save this, and now you notice once we save that, here on the left side we have one link enable and we can see read more option here. So once we click on read more, it is going to open this link on a new tab. I'm not going to do that, it's just very simple. So now you have seen all the options which are available here. Some of the options I have not explained because those are not really used much. And in case you want to read more about these options, you can go to Grafana website. So in this session, we are going to learn how you can embed any Grafana panel in any of the HTML website using iframe. So let's say this is the website which we have. So this is just a simple HTML page which I have created, and this is the code of that HTML. Okay, so this is pretty simple. There is nothing much here. We just have HTML tags, and in the body, we just have some sample codes. And then what it is doing is it has created a simple web page which is printing this message, basically just a bit of text which I have put out there. Now what we are going to do is, I also have a Grafana panel, and this panel we want to embed in this HTML. Okay, now using this approach you can embed Grafana panels on any of existing website. Okay, so the step is basically going to be pretty much same. We are just going to use iframe in order to embed Grafana panel on this website. Now the step is very simple, but before we do that step, there are some changes which we need to make in the Grafana configuration file. If you don't do those changes, in that case, it is not going to work. And I have been just browsing through, and I have been just actually checking some of the community questions, and I saw many people are struggling on this because the configuration changes which they are supposed to make, they haven't made, and they are just trying to embed this panel in HTML website, and that's why they are facing problem. So let's begin by making changes in configuration files. So for that, what we need to do is we need to make changes in /etc/grafana/grafana.ini file. So this grafana.ini file may be at different location based on the which place you have installed Grafana. If you have followed the tutorial of this course, then in that case, you just need to go at this place and need to make changes in grafana.ini file. And the parameters which you need to make changes in is called allow embedding. So by default, allow embedding is set to false. So you need to change that to true. And in the auth.anonymous section, you need to change enable to true. And then org name, you can just give the org name. In my case, I just left it to default. And org role, you need to give any org role which you have created. If you don't have anything, just leave it to default, which is going to be viewer. So where you see these settings, in order to see all of this configuration, you can just go to settings, and then you can, so here you can go to server admin, and then you can click on settings. And here in the settings, you can just verify all of these settings. So for example, let's search with embedding. And now you can see here, allow embedding is set to true because I have already made these configuration changes. But in your case, you are going to see that by default, it is going to be set to false. So if you see this is set to false, it means you need to make changes in configuration file. And similarly, you can also verify about anonymous parameter. So here you can see auth.anonymous. By default, enabled is set to false. In my case, I have already made changes here, so that's why it is showing as true. Org name I have just left is default.
Augural also I have left as a default. Now let me show you from the backend. So here this is a grafana.ini file which we need to make changes in. So I have opened it in VI editor, and then we are just going to search with embed, and here you can see that allow embedding is set to true. Okay, by default it was set to false. Now I have already made changes and set it to true. Also make sure whenever you make any changes you remove a semicolon which is in the beginning of this statement. Okay, so after this we need to search about anonymous. So you can use any editor which you want. In my case I'm just using a VI editor, but you can use any editor. So in this case enabled was set to false. I have changed enabled to true and also remove semicolon which you are going to see in front of enabled. So remove any semicolon which is prefixed here. And here in the org name you can give any org name if you have created. If you have not created anything, just remove semicolon and leave everything else as it is. And similarly in org role, just remove the semicolon from the beginning and leave the everything as it is if you have not made any or you have not created any org role. So these are the changes which you need to make, and after that just save and exit from here. And you also need to restart Grafana. So in order to restart Grafana, all you have to do is you can use a sudo space systemctl space restart space Grafana hyphen server, hit enter, and then you are going to basically restart Grafana. And once you are done with that, again go back to the panel which you have created, and then now we are going to actually use the steps which are going to help us in embedding this panel in HTML website. So what we need to do is click here on the title of this panel, and then we are going to see options. So here from the available options we are going to click on share. So from share, now you can see you have three options. We have link, we have snapshot, we have embed. So what we need to do is we need to select embed. So once you click on embed, these are the code which we are going to use. So I'm just going to copy everything, and then we need to make changes in this HTML file. So in this case, I'm just going to paste whatever we have copied here. And what it is basically doing is it is creating an iframe, and in that iframe it is going to embed this panel. And by default this is the width and height which is going to be. You can make changes here. Someone who's dealing with web development, he'll be understanding what are the changes which can be made here, but this is basically pretty simple thing. And once you are done with these changes, just save it, and now you can go back to your website and just refresh your website. And in that case now you should be able to see now you can see that the dashboard weather trend panel has been embedded here, and I'm able to see this here on my website. So that's how easy it is in order to set up or in order to embed any panel, Grafana panel, in any of the existing website. If you have any question, please feel free to ask in Q&A section. I'll be more than happy to answer.